Hello, fiends, and welcome to the Monster Party Podcast, now a part of the Fangoria Podcast Network. For more information about the network, including other programs, how to follow the show, and find past episodes of Monster Party, please visit fangoria.com.
And now, it's party time.
Greetings, everyone, and welcome to another mysterious episode of Monster Party.
Monster Party.
Monster Party.
Yes. Monster Party.
Yeah.
Mysterious. Excitement in a bottle.
Yes, it is. And we have a very exciting
vodka bottle.
Show. Yes. And who are you, sir?
I am Matt Weinhold.
I am Shawn Sheridan.
I am Larry Strothe.
And I am James Gonis.
And we have got kind of a special topic.
Yeah.
This topic
is a cool one.
Comes from the twisted, sick mind of Shawn Sheridan.
It's, it does. Yes.
I would agree with you about sick and twisted.
God, yes. I'd hate to live in that head.
You're welcome anytime.
Matt, what is our topic?
The topic is ripoffs and wannabes.
Ripoffs and wannabes.
Horror and sci-fi ripoffs.
And wannabes?
And wannabes.
And wannabes. Okay. Not wallabies.
Not wallabies.
Okay, wannabes.
Okay.
Riptides and wallabies.
Yes. But ripoffs and wannabes. Now we're talking horror, sci-fi, fantasy.
Okay, yeah, but sure. Specifically, like, what do you mean, like, a ripoff or a wannabe? Like,
well, now, this is going to be one of those topics where we kind of go back and forth of what is necessarily a ripoff,
what is
a wannabe, or an homage.
Because a ripoff could be good. I mean, a really good.
Well, and that's the thing, too, is that sometimes, like, a blatant ripoff doesn't mean that it's not super entertaining.
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. I have a feeling that Sean's going to rip into stuff that I love.
But you know? Before we get to that,
do I talk yet?
who is our guest?
We have a guest, and man, talk about luck. The luck that we could get this guy, that his schedule worked out with ours.
He's busy all the time.
He's busy all the time. He, and I mean this sincerely, he is truly one of my favorite comics of all time.
Cool.
Yes.
Really?
Living.
At this table.
And we might know him from...
Oh, my God. Bob's Burgers.
Oh, hey. he does Bob's Burgers.
Yeah, he does all kinds of voiceover work. Much. Adventure Time, home movies. Just a great comic and a true fan of the things that we love. Ladies and gentlemen, Ron Lynch.
Ron Lynch! Yay!
Hello, why am I saying yay?
Because you're thrilled to be here, and we're thrilled to have you.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. I'm very excited.
Yeah?
I've been waiting for this moment.
Yeah. No, it's been
worlds colliding.
Yeah, yeah. It's been pretty great just working towards this moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's been a lot of eating, some drinking.
Uh-huh. Hey, people.
You've threatened to leave a number of times
already.
Yeah.
But it's amazing what some food and some drinks can make you do.
That's right.
So, oh, yeah, the third drink did it.
Yeah.
Well, once again, alcohol saves the day.
Well, we are thrilled to have you to talk about ripoffs and wannabes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
And this is people or movies or TV shows, right? It could be anything.
Well, movies and TV shows, right?
Yeah, movies, TV shows. I'm interested that you said people because I want to know how that's going to go.
People?
People.
Like a ripoff?
A person who is a ripoff or a person who is a wannabe who is genre related?
Right. Somebody who wants to be like someone else and so they act that way. And
right.
They think that's going to make them popular.
Huh, that's
I wish
true.
I had examples.
Me most of my life?
All right. Yeah. All right, this is great. But I want to get to this topic.
Okay, all right. But I think it's only fair
that
we allow Shawn Sheridan, who had the gall to come up with this topic, to lead this thing out, because I know that this is a guy who has seen
everything.
Everything, and especially when it comes to ripoffs and wannabes, he has turned me on to so many things.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Well, if it weren't for
the country of Turkey.
And honestly, Sean has introduced us to many, I mean, me too, to many other things. I don't know. No, I mean, he spends a lot of time
alone.
Yes.
I think when I was thinking of this topic, I was thinking a lot of movie and TV ripoffs of films that are hugely popular movies
right.
that just spawned lots of cheap imitators
right.
for whatever reason. You know, and so one of the films that I thought it was a good example of that would be 1979's Alien.
Yes.
The original Alien.
Yes.
When that came out, yes. I mean, it was a huge Fox hit,
mm-hmm.
but you suddenly saw just like a slew of like creatures stuck in a spaceship or a space station kind of movies with chest bursting things flying out of people.
Yeah.
And there was just tons of movies. So there really was like this whole like genre of like alien ripoffs.
Yeah, some people even tried to like rip off Giger's design.
Absolutely. I mean, you saw very much. Oh. Yeah.
And there's one that comes to mind right off the bat.
Okay.
You probably know this one.
Yeah.
Scared to Death.
The William Malone movie.
Yes, William Malone. That's right. That's right.
That had the Singenor.
Yes.
Is that how you say it?
Yeah.
Singenor.
I have that. I think
I have that mask.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. It stands for.
By the way,
yeah, it is.
It stands for synthesized genetic organism. Singenor. Get it?
Oh.
Huh?
Wow, you memorized that.
I did, yes. Yeah.
Now, do you remember the premise of that movie, though? Because it had the look of an alien creature. But
it looked very... I always forget how it's pronounced. Giger? Geiger?
Yeah.
Giger. Right.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
It's Giger.
Giger.
Let's just agree to call it Giger.
I know it
is Giger. He's right.
It's Giger. See?
Yes.
See?
Which I never knew until he passed away last year. And then I heard people say Giger. It's like, oh, Giger.
Well, you could have listened to me years ago.
Because
I was right.
I never listened to you.
No.
Sorry.
Though it's spelled the same as Geiger counter.
Yes.
That's true.
But the pronunciation was different. Uh-huh. But we digress from the actual point.
I'm just going to make very little insignificant points as we go.
I wouldn't have it any other way. Okay.
Did Geiger?
That's why you're here.
So
Geiger counter have an E in it? Though?
I don't think so.
Scared to death.
Okay.
Yeah. Scared to death.
I think it was like a genetic experiment or whatever, right? Gone awry kind of thing. You know, this creature is loose.
This company has bioengineered this creature and it gets loose.
Right. I don't think it was an actual alien from outer space.
It was not.
But it was a ripoff in that it was like a very similar looking to like the alien.
Now, the date on it, Matt, I think was it 1980? Because Alien came out in 1979, and this came out in 1980.
So it was like one of the first ones.
And I remember when I grew up in San Jose, there was a place called Larry's Costume Shop, and they had all these great masks, monster masks and stuff. And there was also a magic shop that it was in Los Gatos that had fewer masks. But I went in there one day, and they had that mask. The mask of the Singenor. And Matt, at that time...
You just liked it because it was a cool mask.
Because Matt, I'd seen Alien, and I would love an alien mask to wear, you know...
This was like the closest thing you could get?
Yes, it was, because they didn't have... You know, it's funny, here today, you know, in our present day, sure, you can get an actual alien mask, the big Giger designed one.
It's a whole new world.
But back in 1980, Matt... You know, this was the closest thing. And so I remember it was like a whole $35.
That was a lot back then.
It was. But I saved up and I got it. And I still have it to this day.
And it's probably worth $37.
Well, you know, it's been used a bit. And no, I don't
Wait a minute, it's been used a bit?
Well, yeah, I've worn it.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
the back is a little ripped. You know, I put it on.
You loved it. That's surprising to me. This is a guy who never uses anything.
Well, he doesn't unseal things,
is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that is correct.
Yes. Larry is the king of unsealed, unopened.
This is classic. Larry Strothe. And I love it. I love it. He buys three of everything.
No, that's not.
One to open.
Right.
One to keep in the package.
Yes.
And one just in case.
Right. Okay. Now, listen. For our listeners.
You can sell one,
Matt is exaggerating a bit. I don't
Am
go
I?
Out. Yes, you are. I don't.
I don't think so.
Look,
I will later, but not this
well,
at this point.
It is true that I have purchased three of a particular item, but not everything.
Not everything.
And that
not the Singenor mask.
And that mask was so expensive. And, you know, and what's really cool is maybe I should put this picture on Facebook. I lined up all my masks right above our record player, you know, and you
know, phonograph.
Yes, yes. And I remember people coming in the room and seeing the monster mask, and that was like my primo monster mask.
Well, you know, William Malone, I think, designed the creature for the movie too. He actually built and designed it.
He designed it, did he?
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow.
He did. Yeah, and I think he actually did some work at Don Post.
Oh, okay.
I remember I was at a convention and they had the premiere of this movie.
Really?
And I had never heard of it. And they premiered it, and he was there, and they showed it, and it's a movie.
Slow budget.
With a Singenor. Yeah. That's about as much as I can say nice things about it.
Now, eventually, I'm sure maybe we'll get him on our show one time, but he actually admitted that when he was making the film, he really didn't know what he was doing. But he had
clear.
But he had a really neat design.
He had the neat design.
Yeah, and then
the actress in the movie was there, too. And we had just watched the movie, and she's dreadful. And the fact that, like, and here she is. Like, why would you do this to yourself? These are sci-fi fans. The most unforgiving type of fans you're going to get.
Mm-hmm.
And, wow, you were brave. But they were nice to her.
Were they?
Yeah.
That's good.
Well, and so, look, Bill Malone, he's a really nice guy. And he admits that... Like,
he restored Robbie the Robot.
Yeah,
he's all right with me.
He did. He
That's
has
right.
the original Robbie the Robot in his house.
Which, yes.
Yeah, hopefully I'll visit one day.
But now, Sean... Name some of the other alien ripoffs.
Well, one that I think just a year later, I really love this movie, actually. This is definitely, it's an alien ripoff to a point, but then also it's kind of very original in its own way. And that would be Galaxy of Terror.
Mm. I do like that.
1981.
Did you ever
Galaxy
see this, Ron?
Of Terror. That was...
is that the one with Aaron Moran?
The cast of this movie is amazing, actually. Aaron Moran, Zalman King.
Aaron Moran from...
Ray Walston.
Happy Days.
Zalman King was in it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ray Walston.
Ray Walston, Edward Albert, Sid Haig, Robert Englund, Grace Zabriskie, who was the mom from Twin Peaks.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. She's great.
And Taffy O'Connell, who is famous for being... kind of like sexually assaulted by a giant space worm in real life? No, in the film.
I forgot about that.
Yes, but actually, it's a very it's a really low budget movie about these space crew that goes to this abandoned planet, but they find this kind of strange kind of abandoned pyramid structure there. Yeah. And basically, it's kind of like they're going into hell because the power or the force of the pyramid is pulling like all their deepest fears out of their imaginations, and so they're kind of killed
like
by
show.
Their imagination. Yeah. So like Aaron Moran is, I think she's like has claustrophobia, so she's stuck in this like tiny little place and kind of implodes. and of course, and
art imitates life.
And yeah, so the Taffy O'Connell's character, she's afraid of worms, of course, so she's attacked by a giant worm. But no, it's a really clever movie. Done in a really low budget, but
I do
makes
like
the
it.
Most of its budget. And actually, James Cameron was involved with like
second
AD. I think he did some of the set design.
Yeah.
It has a lot of very exploitive elements in it. I think it's a Roger Corman.
It is a
production.
I was going to say it's a Roger Corman one.
But
and
like,
it all takes place in the pyramid.
Yes, it's all that kind of dark, you know, dank, you know, space set. But like, really makes the most of its money. Like,
yeah, they
it's
do.
Really
they
up
do a
the
lot
screen.
With very
yeah,
little.
It's really fun. It's a good one.
Now, if we're going to talk about ripoffs and Alien, you could almost say that Alien is kind of a ripoff when you think about it.
Well, I know where you're going.
Well, if you were the maker of It, the Terror from Beyond Space,
there
you'd
go.
Be screaming ripoff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
But years later...
Or Planet of the Vampires from Mario Bava.
A little bit, right.
So enough time had passed. So, okay, it's an homage.
Do you remember the date on It, the Terror from Beyond Space?
That was 1958.
58, yeah.
And... Planet of the Vampires is more of a stylistic thing.
I agree.
Whereas It, the Terror from Beyond Space is a movie that... Have you ever seen that, Ron?
Of course.
Classic black and white.
You
kind
of did a one-man show, didn't you, of It, the Terror from Beyond Space?
I did. I acted it out word for word.
Yeah. And it's interesting that you played It and everyone else.
Right. Right.
So you did the whole...
And yet it was seamless.
I killed myself three times.
Very close.
Right?
He's very
Am
close
right?
to the kill.
Well, you know, I'm going to go out on a limb here. It's so funny that you'd say this. You know,
what year is this film? I'm sorry.
1958.
1958. Okay. And it is... You should see this film, Ron.
Really,
because,
really.
Because it is amazing after seeing Alien to watch this movie and realize that it's like almost beat for beat.
Well,
Alien.
Well, here's the funny
right.
thing, Ron.
Oh,
Ron,
wow.
Think about it. So with the movie Alien, written by Dan O'Bannon, you know, directed by Ridley Scott, here this film is, it seems like it's very unique and stylistic. It's awesome. It's really amazing. And I was going to admit to you, Matt, that I'm a guy who loves 50s science fiction films. I had never seen It, the Terror from Beyond Space until after I saw
it. Is that right? Really?
So, yeah, I think I tell the story about my dad and I. We went to see the movie Alien back in 79 together. You know, the advertisement was out. People had always said, oh my God, it's the scariest movie of all time. And so my dad says, Larry, let's go and see it. We saw it and it freaked me out and stuff. And I thought, oh my God, this is so amazing. Years later, Matt, I'll never forget it, sitting and watching It, the Terror from Beyond Space.
Did it dawn on you,
Matt,
yourself?
I flipped out and went, wait, because there's the scene where you're going through the tunnel in the spaceship. And I'm like, oh my God.
You know the scene, Ron, you know the scene in Alien where like Dallas is in the tubes with the flamethrower thing and they're hunting down the alien.
They're hunting down the creature.
Yeah.
I mean, there's that scene.
Wow. That scene. And yeah, and also the other thing is it's basically a creature getting stuck or gets onto the spaceship, which is now in outer space.
Now in outer space, yeah.
Going back home.
Yeah. And there's some different twists. Like the main character, they think that the main character he's on Mars and everybody on this Mars station has been killed and they think this guy has done it.
Yeah.
And they're taking him back to be tried.
Yeah.
And he says, no, it's not me. Yeah. There's a creature. And they're like, yeah, fine, sure, whatever.
The thing is, it's such a basic concept, though. It's just a monster loose in a spaceship killing people. I just don't know if like Dan O'Bannon saw that and said, oh,
I'm sure he did.
I think that a lot of people that do sci-fi and stuff like that is that they had to have seen those 50s sci-fi movies. I mean, you'd watch all of them if you were then into that kind of thing.
Of course.
And you would take the best things out of it, you know?
But wouldn't you say, though, that isn't it kind of weird, though, that you would see a movie and you would get it like beat for beat?
Well, that's a ripoff, yeah. That is a ripoff. But
they did it well. I'm not
they
saying
did it well,
yeah,
right.
And that's one where I would say it's a ripoff, but it's a great ripoff.
Well, right. I do think that a lot of people don't like me don't know about It, the Terror from Beyond Space. I really don't think it's that. Well, I mean, I know
you've opened a can of worms.
You're looking at me. You're giving me that look. It's a classic. It's a classic 50s film. But Alien is very well known. And then you had Aliens and Alien 3. And I
love
Aliens.
Well, see, I see them as a ripoff and wannabe is something that is trying to ride the tide of a current or
that would be
a
more
recent,
of a wannabe or?
Well, this is the ones I'm looking at were ones that like, you know, blockbuster movies and like a bunch of other
Galaxy
of
Terror and all
the,
those. It's yeah, Forbidden like, World. Is that kind
Forbidden
of the
World's
same
another
thing?
One. Yeah. Yeah, right.
Another Corman.
Yeah,
right. Kind of.
But
rehash.
So it's kind of that's why. Dan O'Bannon probably did see It, the Terror from Beyond Space, and maybe even subconsciously, it's in his mind, he kind of wrote Alien. But you know, Alien, when it comes down to it, is really a haunted house movie. You know, on a spaceship.
Alien is way more of a gothic horror story than It, the Terror from Beyond Space. Yes. I would agree with you there. Yeah.
Isn't it like taking the story into the future? Like, isn't it taking something from the past and making it more of the mythology of the future by redoing it in a way?
Yeah. Well, you could say that for like Star Wars. They took the old Flash Gordon serials
and
made them.
Just because they weren't that creative and they stole someone else's idea.
Well, you know, here's a funny thing too. I mean, if you look at Alien and Star Wars, you know, I mean, you say, well, Star Wars is basically, you know, it's all these serials, you know, put together, and there's a lot more money
well, that's
that
the
went
inspiration
into it.
For yeah, them. Sure, right. Sure. Just like, right.
But and I wouldn't say that Star Wars ripped off Flash Gordon, the early serials, because I think that Star Wars gave you something that was really new.
Mm-hmm. And Lucas was very vocal about how Flash Gordon influenced him and was an influence on Star Wars.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, like the credit crawl. Yeah. I mean, the crawl in the beginning is exactly
out of
like
Flash
the
Gordon.
Flash
yeah.
Gordon
yeah.
serials.
But that's,
Buster
I would
Crab.
Say that is yeah. more an homage than a ripoff.
Sure.
Yes.
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So would we agree that Alien, ripoff sounds so nasty to me, you know? I mean, I would say it's more of a, Alien would be
How
more
about
of an homage.
A friendly theft.
but you also brought up Planet of the Vampires because the way it looks with and also the giant dead alien.
Right. That's the main thing that people point to. That's because the space jockey and Alien looks a lot like the.
It's more that is more of whereas Alien is this modern gothic horror movie in space. Yeah. That's kind of what Planet of the Vampires is. It's more of a horror film, really, than It, the Terror from Beyond Space is.
Okay, let me ask you a goofy question. Now, you, Ron, you've seen Planet of the Vampires, right?
I don't know. I'm going to say yes, but I don't
know. I'm sure you have. But wouldn't you agree, Matt?
You've seen Star Wars, right?
Star what?
Matt, stylistically, the look, the costumes, the sets look great. I found to be like a little slow.
Which one?
Planet of the Vampires.
Oh,
but really? If people were gonna go out and see one of the two, I'd say go see It, the Terror from Beyond Space, over Planet of the Vampires.
Apples and oranges.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's very. Yeah.
It's nice crisp and apple and an old.
No.
Orange.
Oh my God.
Moldy orange.
Mario Bava. Every scene is a painting.
It really is.
No. It's beauty. It looks
but
beautiful.
It, the Terror from Beyond
creepy.
Space is just like a low budget. Programmer, it doesn't attain to something more, which Bava was trying to do with Planet of the Vampires. Okay, it's a beautiful, stylish movie.
It looks beautiful, but I thought it moved a little slow. I mean, it, the Terror from Beyond Space, gets
the
monster. I'm just saying, James, back me up here. You've seen both.
Why
aren't
they fighting?
I like both of them for their own merits.
For their own merits,
they are
apples and oranges.
Really. Yeah, I think so.
All right, well,
Ron, what do you feel about apples and oranges?
Two different kinds of fruit.
That's true.
You can't. You're saying if you count three apples, it's not three oranges.
No, it's right? Entirely different.
Exactly. Am I helping here?
You have six pieces of fruit, and they have that. They have that going for them.
Can I make a point?
Oh God, please! Someone has to.
Now we're talking about ripoffs and wannabes, and I think we have to address the fact that there is a big movie, and then that movie has graphics and a name. And then this actually dates back to the VHS tapes, but the cover of the ripoff, which is a complete ripoff but really crappy movie, has like a similar name and a graphic that looks like the graphic of the movie.
Right.
And it's totally playing on the stupidity of Americans to go in and go, oh, here's that movie.
That's right.
It wants to deliberately confuse the
consumer.
It's trying
to fool you.
I just wanted to make sure that wasn't going to go past us. I mean,
That's a great point because it's not an accident.
Animations that happens a lot.
I will say this, Ron. You say stupidity. I'm not sure if it's complete stupidity.
No.
Look, when your mom, hey, did you go to the video rentals place with your mom and your mom is walking through?
No,
not with my mom. No.
Did you?
Excuse me, Larry.
Last
year.
Listen. We're talking back in the 80s.
Ron, listen. By the time video rental places started to open up, we were about 16, 17.
We were going.
And so you 16, 17 year old Larry going there with your mom.
I don't know if you remember
friend. What?
No. I don't know if you remember, but you couldn't. You think, you just put down $2 and you're able to rent it. No, not when they first came out. You had to use a credit card. And remember,
had to get a membership fee.
I remember getting the account going.
Look, there was a point I was trying to make when I went with my mom or my dad. We go and we rent, and mom would say, here's that movie. I mean, she doesn't really know. You know, she's not really paying much attention to the whole world.
You're relying, the sci-fi fan who reads Famous Monsters, are relying on your mother to pick out your movie choices.
She would come along, but I would say to her,
what the fuck happened to you?
Finish the story.
Yeah, see, Matt likes to interrupt. Yes, Matt just constantly likes to interrupt me.
I know
he
it's
does
be
that
bad,
all.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Larry.
I was just trying to say that when your parent came with you, obviously you guys were hooligans. You guys went on your own.
Hooligans.
Larry, you're just saying that your mother determines what you watch.
No, I didn't say that. I didn't say that.
That's okay.
She went to come to see what else is there to make sure I wasn't going to pick out The Exorcist or something like that.
Right.
And she would say,
why don't we rent The Cross and the Switchblade? Pat Boone.
All right.
Larry, can I ask you a question? No. Can I ask everyone else to shut up?
Yes. Sure. Yes, Ron.
Larry,
he's our guest.
Did she ever rent something that was not the actual movie, but it was a ripoff of that movie?
Yes.
Oh, good point.
Yeah, actually, I believe so.
Is that
so.
Where you were going with the story?
Yeah, because I think I wanted Forbidden Planet, and I think we got Forbidden World instead.
Really?
Yeah. Right? It's
very
great.
Different movies.
Yeah, but because Forbidden Planet, it's classic Robbie the Robot.
Ron, we have the poster of Forbidden World behind us, and actually when you look at the title, the graphics...
Yeah,
it looks
very similar
to Forbidden Planet.
Yeah, the graphic, yes, and also the creature there could be interpreted as the id creature from Forbidden Planet.
Maybe,
actually,
or alien.
Yes, right. Or alien, and there's
we'll put
a pretty
it up
girl
on Facebook.
Yeah, we'll put it up on Facebook.
No, but Ron's right. But as far as like these lower budget movies were just trying to kind of fool audiences into
saying, that's a very good point.
Oh, if Alien was good, then this is going to be good.
Look how cheap it is. Let's right. get it.
Yeah.
Totally. Remember all the Star Wars copies that were like the poster art was, they always had a robot in it. It was done exactly like.
It's funny you say that because I wanted to touch upon that. I wanted to say, okay, classic film Star Wars, 1977, the film that stands alone. When that film came out, you know, we all went to see it. We were all blown away. And at that time, all the studios go, oh my God, we didn't know that science fiction would be so big. So everyone rushed to try to make their own version of Star Wars.
Not just low budget companies, though, either. No. I mean, all the other big studios then jumped on Battlestar Galactica.
Okay, because there would be no Battlestar Galactica if there were Star Wars.
And I want to talk about Battlestar Galactica because.
Same kind of effects, too.
I have a love hate relationship with it. You know,
Me too.
Because at that time, you know, unlike today, you know, there's so much, you know, space stuff out there. But for us, back in 77, we were so desperate for anything.
It was Star Wars on TV every week. I mean, for a little kid, that's what it was.
Right.
Well, I didn't even know that Battlestar was a ripoff of Star Wars. I didn't even think of that when I saw that. I don't even think I watched much of the original show. But
I did.
When I looked at stuff for maybe the show today, and I realized all those parallels.
Yeah,
it's pretty crazy.
It is crazy. Mm. Yeah,
and I didn't see it at all though when I saw the show.
And you were talking about, you know, the things when you look at the box and you go, oh, this looks like a Star Wars kind of poster.
Yeah,
right.
With Battlestar Galactica, I remember looking at the poster is kind of similar in the style of artwork.
Yeah,
and then the special effects, which were John Dykstra,
who did Star Wars,
and they really look like Star Wars.
Yeah,
right. But
it's a very different thing.
It is different. And then you think about it, there's stormtroopers in Star Wars, Cylons
who look like stormtroopers,
and they're chrome.
Look like Darth Vader. Yeah. Right. Silver Darth Vader.
The Vipers look like X-Wings. Yes. The Cylon Raiders look like the Millennium Falcon. I mean, it was definitely.
However,
when I saw that, I thought, why didn't I see this? I didn't even see this when I saw that show.
And you want to know something funny, Sean? Do you know what my first piece of Battlestar Galactica was? This is what it was for me. I didn't even know about the TV series. You know, I'm so hungry for anything space. And when my folks and I, I went to the store with my folks, okay, back in 78, okay? I went to the store at Gemco, and they had in the toys section with the models, and there were these spaceship models.
So you saw the toys before the models first,
Sean.
Oh, wow.
I saw it first.
You know what? I think I did too.
Yeah, and the model kits.
Model kits came out first.
It piqued my interest. I'm like, what the hell is this? What is this Battlestar Galactica?
Well, you know why? They're smart because remember when Star Wars hit,
there was no merchandise at first.
So they were smart to not change that.
Before Battlestar Galactica came out, I remember going with my parents to the Universal Studios tour.
Oh my gosh, yes.
And we're driving through the back lot, and there's a spaceship.
Okay.
And the person driving the tram goes, oh, that's from our upcoming series. And they just called it Galactica.
Wow. No.
And I remember going, ooh, wow. Because also, that's the other thing, too, is that we're so, as sci-fi fans, we're so hungry for anything science fiction on television or anything.
Yes.
Right.
That, like, oh my God, there's a spaceship show that's coming.
Yes.
Yeah, and I remember liking the original pilot movie.
Yes.
And then the second episode, and I don't know if this is how the episodes were supposed to be released.
But
I remember the second one was that one with the Cylon gunslinger.
Yes.
You guys remember that?
That was the second one?
Yeah.
That's the second one I saw, too. And the minute you go into like
old Western
Wild
town
West
sets.
space.
You don't make that jump right away.
No, that's way too early.
That should be in the third season, actually.
That's like doing a bottle show in the third episode.
Yeah.
You know? That's like we're just taking advantage of the back lot at Universal.
Of course, yeah.
But, you know, but Matt, just getting back to the Battlestar Galactica, I mean, I was so hungry for it, and I was desperate for it, even though some of the stuff was bad. It was like, well, Starbuck is kind
of
like Han Solo.
Of course, that was the idea.
Apollo smokes
kinda,
a cigar.
Yes, yeah, and he gambles. And then Apollo, he's a good guy. He's kind of like Luke Skywalker, you know?
Yeah, there's definitely...
There was really no R2-D2 and C-3PO, although there was the Daggett, the...
Yeah, that was your R2-D2 equivalent.
And as much as I hated Boxy, the little boy, you know, that Apollo basically adopts, I wanted to be that kid.
I felt sorry for the chimp inside that costume.
Wait, was it a chimp, really?
That was a chimp? Yeah, it was a chimp.
Yeah.
For some reason, I thought it was Billy Barty.
Don't chimps have... No. You always wonder why chimps eventually rip off your face?
That's why. Yeah.
Maybe that's it.
Did you think daggers? It was a guy inside a chip costume inside a costume?
No, I you know what? No, when I originally. No, when
that
I originally.
Horrible.
Come on, guys. Come on. Everyone.
Terrible.
See,
worst acting job ever.
Right.
See, and everyone jumps a Larry. Of course it was
why
a chip.
Why do I have to be a chip? First, why does that?
This makes
happen?
No sense. It's because we like hurting things.
We want people to think it's a chimp.
look. I thought when I saw little Daggett, you know, walk along, I thought it was actually a person in there.
It
but
was
how
pretty
cool.
good. It was pretty
and,
good.
And look. Matt's looking at me like I'm an idiot. No, Matt.
No,
I know.
Just,
come
I'm
on.
Laughing at Ron. I'm still in that moment
because you think, oh, of course it was a chimp. No, not everyone knew it was a chimp. But I will say this, you know. They came out with the action figures. You know, they came out with these great action figures.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, the little action figures.
It wasn't a dog.
No, right?
You know
right?
that, right?
Yeah, yes, yes. I knew it wasn't a dog.
That'd be fucked up.
You're saying people actually thought it was an alien creature?
I thought it was a person inside the little Daggett. Okay.
If you thought it was a dog inside, person. It would have to be two dogs, right? Wouldn't it? To work both sides
well,
it of
it? Depends on how you attach them.
Look. Obviously,
human centipede.
Obviously, Battlestar Galactica, it had huge ratings at first, and then because it couldn't...
It was an expensive show to do, though,
it was
too.
$1 million.
$1 million
at that time.
Even as a little kid, though, I immediately saw how they just keep reusing the same spaceship shots over and over again, because it could be only so much... It was a fortune to make the show.
Well, I think Glenn Larson, he was interviewed, and they said, yes, it was so expensive to produce all those special effects, and so they did start using...
It was a ripoff of itself.
And... The thing that gets me though is even though Star Trek at the time had already gone into syndication and was making money, they couldn't foresee that, you know, look, if we stuck with it, if we're losing money for, let's say, 2 years, 3 years, get enough to so it can go into syndication, they could have made a ton of money in the long run.
And what happened, too, is really pathetic, too, because the show was so expensive to make, and then what they did was, for the last season, they made Galactica 1980, which is so bad. It was like now they get to Earth.
Do you remember that, Ron?
They find Earth.
It was like Kent McCord.
I was off the horse at that point, I think.
Yeah.
You were like girls entered in the picture at that point, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was bad.
That was like Aftermath.
Not for us.
It was like Aftermath. Aftermath had more science fiction
or the
than Animal Act in 1980. Yeah. I mean, it was bad.
But for our listeners, if you weren't familiar with Battlestar Galactica 1980, so it's like the whole point of Battlestar Galactica, we're trying to get to Earth. And I thought it would be this thing where they never actually would get there. You know, generations go, but they actually get to Earth, and it takes place in 19.
And now the show is basically. So we're on Earth.
Yeah, exactly. Like, so what
like
now?
I forget what it was. It was something like they were there, but they didn't want the silence to know, so they kind of secretly went on Earth and tried to infiltrate the society
like
or something.
They had like flying motorcycles.
It was terrible.
And don't you remember
the
children? It's like, oh, we're on Earth, and now we have superpowers.
Yeah,
so it's like,
right,
like
because it was like Superman because their molecular structure was different, so they could jump high, and it was terrible.
And you know what, Sean? That pissed me off. That made me mad.
Yeah,
that made
me
angry.
But James has no memory of that show.
You know why? Ron, you were probably so disgusted with it, you went, I can't watch this, and you burned it out of your head.
You
dodged a blaster.
That's like a weapon that you
now, James, were you a fan of Battlestar Galactica? Or
I was not, because...
No, you're watching sitcoms. You're watching...
No. Okay.
Hello, Larry.
I don't want to come off like I was more sophisticated at 12.
But you're going to try.
Excuse me,
but
Mr. Gonis.
I saw Battlestar Galactica as the shameless ripoff that it was, and I thought, this isn't worth my time.
Let him talk.
Weren't you guys just a little, like, you're all bright guys, right? Even at 12. didn't you know this is just a shameless ripoff?
But James, we were hungry for anything sci-fi on TV. That's what it was.
I wanted as much outer space as I could.
I loved Star Wars, but I didn't love it that much that I would waste my time on Galactica. Although
you're busy watching Annie Hall in the theaters.
I will say this. I did develop a kind of an interest in Buck Rogers, which Glenn Larson produced almost
afterwards.
Simultaneously.
Well, I did too.
Which is also a Star Wars ripoff.
Yes, absolutely.
A little more looser and kind of more comedic in some ways.
More sitcom-y, which is maybe why it appealed more to me.
Yeah, but I enjoyed it though.
Ron,
I enjoyed the first season.
I got
season.
Mad at Buck Rogers.
I'm with you.
I got mad at it. I have no idea why.
Well,
I think
you know why.
I think I know why.
Stop making that show.
Yeah, it's
wrong.
Yeah,
it's wrong.
It's but Love Boat in Space.
Exactly. But that's why it's fun, though. It's cheesy fun, though. No, but I fucking hated Love Boat. Galactica took itself too seriously, though. And Buck Rogers.
I preferred that than Buck Rogers.
Was fun. Gil Gerard, you know, dancing around with Princess Ardala.
I know you love Tweaky. Tweaky, I wanted to see destroyed after every episode.
Tweaky's awesome.
That fucking robot.
I know we're all jumping all over us. You know, look, for our listeners, you know, Buck Rogers TV show.
Are you really explaining Buck Rogers? Sean, it was a wannabe.
It was first released in theaters.
Which is different from Battlestar Galactica, because Battlestar Galactica came out as a TV series, and what they did is they release it as a feature film with a different ending.
Yes, and in Censorum.
Because what happens...
Yes, where Baltar gets killed.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah,
thanks.
Yeah, fuck you, everybody.
Go fuck yourselves. Why do you do that? Why do you wreck it for everybody?
If you haven't gotten on the bus with Battlestar Galactica by now, then don't listen to us anymore.
Why are you so mean to our listeners?
It was the opposite for Buck Rogers. Actually, it was made to be on TV, but Glenn Larson was so happy with the pilot, he decided, let's put this in theaters and make some more money first.
Yeah, Larry.
And then they released it as a series.
Now, Ron.
Thanks for joining us on Monster Party. We're talking about wannabes and ripoffs of various shows. I know we don't seem like we're talking about that, but... We are. We're talking about things that have been ripped off.
Thank you, Ron.
So, Larry, you went into the video store with your mother.
Yeah, but I think we've already passed that story.
Oh, we did.
Yeah, yeah. I think we should revisit it.
No, I want to get back to Buck Rogers really quickly.
Did she pick out your clothes?
No. Listen. I know that Sean and his lovely wife Gina really
she
love
is
Buck,
lovely.
She well, is, I, and they love Buck Rogers.
The second season blows.
Oh, okay.
Really?
Look, yes.
What's the difference?
No, there is a difference. I'm gonna go. Look, Matt and I don't agree on everything, but I am gonna agree with him on this. Matt Tweaky again pissed me off like crazy.
Really?
Ron, how'd you feel about Tweaky?
It was an ape, right?
No, he wasn't an ape. He was a little robot.
No.
Why are you guys lying? Oh. It was a little person in a little robot costume. But the thing that pissed me off about
Billy
him,
Barty no. was forced to wear an ape costume.
No.
And then jammed into a
Okay, listen,
actually, it was
back,
Felix Silla.
Listen,
yeah.
getting
Felix Silla.
Yes, thank you.
Wow. That character irritated me, if you guys care.
No, okay. he did.
Now, what about Dr. Theopolis?
Thermopolis.
See, you didn't even get it right.
Yeah, the Greek guy
knows. The first Greek robot.
I thought that actor had a good job.
Okay, listen.
He had a good job.
I see you in that role. That would have been interesting.
Okay.
So you as the voice of Dr. Theopolis.
Thermopolis.
Okay, look, for our listeners out there, so Tweaky was the main little robot that was like the buddy
okay,
of Buck.
Okay, come on
Hang
now.
On. And Dr. Yeah. Theopolis
Stop.
Was Thermopolis. The computer that he carried around.
So Tweaky had this little circular computer guy.
And he was
very sophisticated and intelligent. And so what you had is you had the dopey robot.
Well, he was
the
ambiquad that carried around.
But it was idiotic, Sean, because he goes, oh, be.
He was the less.
Groovy. He was a moron.
He was very of mice and men.
He was a moron robot, Sean, and he had to carry. Why would you build a moron robot?
He helped the Buck.
To carry around a scientific genius robot? It makes no sense, Sean. It makes no sense. That's the thing that pissed me off about. Would you agree?
The reason for that is that the intelligent robot cannot use his other abilities to move around and use arms.
Right, he's so smart that
he needs to have someone carry him around.
Exactly.
But now my question.
However, still a horrible character.
But my question would be, hey, what if we put the smart robot in the dumb robot?
Right, and two characters in one.
Yeah.
Now, Sean, I'm going to say, as much as Tweaky bugs the hell out of me...
Tweaky looks like Flavor Flav.
No,
if
he
the watch
he,
or the clock.
Well, actually, you bring up a good point.
The sure, yeah.
I do have, oh, yeah, look, right. Sean, I do have all the Buck Rogers figures, including Tweaky, the little figure.
Hey, yeah. My wife and I have a life-size Tweaky prop in our living room.
Yes, you
so
do.
There
did you,
go. You
know that, yeah. Ron?
There yeah. you go. I said
I can imagine all of you have collected figurines. And,
that's true.
Mm-hmm. I don't have any.
You don't?
Oh. Nothing?
We're going to change that tonight.
Yeah. No, I have a few. I have a
yeah. Yeah, the comedian is telling the truth now.
Now we got to do a little side thing. Which figures do you have, Ron?
I have Jar Jar Binks.
No.
Seriously?
You do not.
Ironic reasons.
Just as a joke.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he's worth a lot of money.
Is that
he
right?
Probably, he probably is, actually.
No, no, he's not.
I bet he is.
No, he's not.
People threw him out.
Yeah, wow. Yeah. But you know what? There has to be a desire for that figure. And
some
there
people,
isn't.
No, nope. I'll bet. No, I'll bet hardcore completist collectors ring a bell, Larry. Need that Jar Jar Binks figure now.
Right.
Because people have thrown him away.
Thrown him away.
Ron, did you get that figure because you like the character or as an investment?
No, somebody gave them to me.
See, here's where you're wrong, Matt, because they made millions and millions and millions of Jar Jar Binks. And I know what you're saying, oh, everyone threw a... No, there are plenty of Jar Jar Binks out there. It's not worth as much money as you think it is.
What else do you have, Ron?
What else do you have?
That's it.
Wow.
Now, if he were to say a Jar Jar Binks life-size figure...
I did collect Toy Story things.
Toy Story.
During that era of Burger King...
Sure. I love all that stuff.
Right,
I have
a
pretty big box of those figurines.
Do you have any figures of characters where you did the voice?
No, they don't make any. They don't make anything that I do the voice of.
I bet Bob's Burgers, that's coming. That's a
yeah,
pretty
not
hot
a main
property.
Character, though.
Yeah,
in
but
fact,
you're...
I haven't done one in probably 30 years.
Well, that's our show.
No, you're right. I would imagine eventually they would do it.
I mean, they did every Simpsons one.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
You're right. Bob's Burgers is doing very well.
It is doing very well.
Okay, so look, we mentioned Star Wars, really big, very successful.
Alien.
So one, okay, but we mentioned only one, Battlestar Galactica, and Buck Rogers. Those are two, but there were a lot more.
What about Space Academy?
Yeah, I mean, basically all those
Jason
Filmation,
of Star Command.
Yeah, all those Filmation 70s.
Like the Han morning. Solo show.
And so those were on Saturday mornings. So it's like Battlestar Galactica, Buck Rogers, they were on an evening. They were like, you know, once a week in the evening. And those two shows that you just mentioned, they were on Saturday mornings.
But,
that's right.
But do you call those ripoffs, though, or more just like riding the tide of science fiction, which was very popular at
but
that time?
But that's kind of what we're talking about.
But no.
But there's a little, there's a cute little robot.
There is a robot.
Peepo.
There's Peepo.
Yeah.
And then there's Jason of Star Command, who is Han Solo.
Pretty much, you're right. That's true.
That
all right,
now
true.
You talked about how Sean knows about Turkish movies.
Oh, here we go.
There's the Turkish Star Wars.
There is. That's right.
No.
Which is on YouTube. I found it on YouTube, but the funny thing is they have no English subtitles. It's just Spanish subtitles of this Turkish Star Wars, in which I think Japan also can do this, but they just have no copyright laws.
Right,
they just use footage from the movie.
Right.
No!
And soundtrack from the movie.
Are you serious?
I didn't know they did that.
Wow, I can't believe I'm educating you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They use soundtrack and actual cuts. You'll see the space. You'll see the Millennium Falcon.
Right.
And you'll see shots from Star Wars. And then it cuts to a really crappy studio picture
of
a cave or something. And the costume is like made out of foam.
Yeah, it's terrible. It's unbelievable.
You have to check out this Turkish Star Wars
thing.
It's called Turkish Star Wars.
Yeah, I mean, the original title is something else.
It's called Turkish Star Wars?
No, probably not. It probably has a Turkish title.
Yeah, actually,
that would be funny though if they did call it that.
Yeah,
because then you couldn't really call it a ripoff.
But it's like a guy like it's like martial arts fights in it. It's like
a couple of things like that.
Like
there's
really,
really
weird.
crappy costumes. And there's one guy that has a sword that has a bunch of jags on it, and as the guy swings it, it's blatantly made out of plywood. Blatantly made out of plywood, and.
That's awesome.
That is a ripoff for sure.
I've never seen that, but that sounds glorious. Yeah,
it's pretty crazy.
And they didn't stop there. Like
No.
The Turks did.
The Turks, they have a lot of just complete ripoffs of movies. And it's just, they just take part of the movie, and then they add really crappy scenes from it. That's the other thing about ripoffs, I think, is when they see the movie and they know it's big, how soon do they decide to make another movie because that has to come out immediately.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Sure,
it has to
right.
be made
sure
really fast in order to make that money from the other movie.
Yeah.
So the budget has to be really tight. They always have to have a semi-known actor.
Right,
Nia Pebbles, or I can't think of who. I don't know why she came to mind.
Robert Vaughn.
Like yeah.
Yeah, right.
Robert
yeah.
Vaughn. And then put their name on the box, and then have a similar cover of it. I have a couple of movies here that I found after I realized I knew the Turkish Star Wars thing, but there was Transmorphers.
I don't know that one.
Transmorphers, which was a ripoff of you know what?
And, no,
no. What is it?
A ripoff of
Transformers.
Transformers, thank you.
Is that from the company called The Asylum? There's a company called The Asylum.
It is a company, right? Exactly. Yeah, it is that company. I think. Yeah. Oh, I think it is that company, right?
Have you seen that one?
And the no, these are things I haven't seen.
But I want to see that. Okay. What is that like?
The tag is the final battle between man and machine, and the day the Earth stopped.
Right, that's right. That was one too, because at the time it was a remake of The Day the Earth Stood Still coming out. Right.
Wait. And there was a remake of The Day the Earth Stood Still, right, exactly.
Right, which ended up bombing, but Asylum didn't know that at the time, so right, you're right, exactly. You're right.
The Day the Earth Stopped.
That's great.
That's a Turkish film?
Thomas Howell and Judd Nelson.
The Asylum.
Wow. They got a couple people.
We met at a party once.
Really?
Oh, my.
Both of them?
It was a party at Kathy Griffith's house, and Judd Nelson was like just sitting around trying to be funny. And I hope he's not listening.
Believe me, he's not.
Thor.
Oh, yes.
Which the cover is the big kick I got out of it. And it's a guy, you could tell it's just like, it's not green screen, it's just graphics, drawn graphics, but it's a guy in a really bad costume just holding a big hammer.
Is it called
a regular hammer, like a craftsman, or
it's a
Thor-ish hammer?
Yeah, it's a costume hammer.
Okay,
and I guess they could make that because they're basing on Norse mythology and not the Marvel comics, so they can get away with it.
Yeah,
right.
It's not
a comic Thor.
Right.
There's another Thor that doesn't exist.
Right.
And it said the legend is born on the cover.
Again,
Richard Grieco plays Loki in it.
I'm just happy that he's working.
Okay, here's my last one. You know the movie Abraham Lincoln Zombie Hunter? Wait, what was it called?
Vampire Hunter.
Vampire Hunter.
Right, yes.
This was Abraham Lincoln versus the zombies. and what is it called? Not the tag. What is it called on the movie where it's the line?
The log line?
The log line, yeah. Maybe it is the log line. He emancipated the slaves. He saved the Union. He slaughtered the undead.
Nice.
Yes.
What can't he do?
You know, I'm not familiar with that one.
But you're right. Those qualify to me as genuine.
Those are ripoffs. Yeah.
And I believe I did see the box of that one or something. The graphics.
I'm sure. Yeah. Yeah,
I think Asylum came out with Titanic 2. If I'm not mistaken.
Really? So,
are you
sequel to really? Like,
I
what,
swear to God.
How?
I don't know, but look it up. It's there.
Sean,
that's hilarious.
And that's one of the shames of video stores not being around. You would see these
you
things
would browse
on the
shelves. Yeah.
You wouldn't look for this at all online.
Right. That's true.
And I could see that fooling
you. Might see the actual physical video and go, "What? I gotta see this."
Right.
Yeah.
Well, now on that kind of track. You're talking about Titanic 2?
Yes.
Well, you could maybe answer this, John, which is that, so Dawn of the Dead, which was titled Zombie in Italy?
Right. George Romero's Dawn of the Dead, when it was released in Italy, it just called it Zombie. And then when Lucio Fulci made his film Zombie, I believe was released as Zombie 2. It was also released as Zombie Flesh Eaters, but I think they released it as Zombie 2, wanting people to think that it was kind of a sequel to Romero's film.
But they were not, they didn't have any agreement or anything.
That may have been also just like the distribution company who did that. I don't know. But they're right. They're completely unrelated, but talk about ripoffs and wannabes. I mean, when Dawn of the Dead came out, it spawned this whole flood of Italian zombie films.
Yeah.
I mean, the Italian film industry is really interesting because they would just glom onto particular popular movies in America and just churn out dozens and dozens. I mean, the fact that like The Road Warrior kept the film Italian film industry in business in the entire 80s as far as like, they made so
1990, The Bronx Warrior.
What was interesting is that both The Road Warrior, the Mad Max films, and John Carpenter's Escape from New York, both of those films, the Italians were fascinated by. They would make Escape from New York ripoffs. They would make road warrior ripoffs. They would make
or merge
combination. Yeah, and it was so weird. But yeah, there were so many. There's like right, the Bronx Warriors is more an Escape from New York ripoff. They made Bronx Warriors 2, but the Road Warrior films. There's like 2019 after the fall of New York, Exterminators in the year 3000, Wheels of Fire, Warrior of the Lost World. I think that was not an Italian one though, but there's so many and they're all kind of interchangeable, but I think there's like there's a particular exploitive element in the Mad Max films that they must see that were like you can take and do it in a cheap way.
Well, that's what I was saying. That's what I was thinking, which is that as Ron was pointing out, the idea that you see a movie and you go, okay, we got to make a ripoff quickly. With Mad Max and those kind of films, it's easy because all you need is a bunch of fucked up motorcycles.
Yeah, and a sand dune.
Right. Some costumes.
And a big
right.
field. Yeah.
Yeah, and a big field, and you drive around, and that's your movie.
Post-apocalyptic world is just,
To rip off a Star Wars type movie, you got to build some shit.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. I know we have brought this up before, but there again, back at that time when we were so hungry for anything that was space-related, there is a film that I would put into the ripoff category, but it's something I absolutely love and adore.
And that's okay.
And I think Sean will agree with me on this, and it partially because my understanding is the spaceships were made in 3 days. They were cut out of wood. They were cut out of wood with different shapes.
The favorite of all of ours.
They
this
took
one.
Model pieces out of model kits. Didn't even bother to take them apart. They put them all on with the little trees. Spray paint them white. Throw some lights. And I'm talking about a classic film called Star Crash.
Ron, have you seen this?
No, but I want to.
Star
Crash is fun.
Look, Star Crash. You know, Ron, you brought up something about these movies. Let's make it fast. Let's throw in a few names that are recognizable. Film, and this follows that exactly. Caroline Munroe, who we love and adore, who is in Golden Voyages, Sinbad, you know, James Bond movie.
You'd know her if you saw her.
I know her.
Okay.
Caroline Munroe.
Yeah.
You had
Beyond Hot.
A young David Hasselhoff. But you have Christopher Plummer. Christopher Plummer, who's, you know, it's a
one of my favorites.
Yeah,
I love
and
that
he's
guy.
Yeah. he's in
and
this.
He's good in this. Actually.
And and yes, there is a kind of a goofy C-3PO type robot with a country western voice, what I love about it is space in outer space. It's not just white stars. It's like Christmas tree lights. They're all colorful,
they really
yellow,
are, yeah.
red,
and they. I'm sure they were Christmas tree lights.
You know what?
Right?
And you know what, Matt? When I looked at it, I was not only mesmerized by it. I thought it was beautiful, and I thought I could make this.
You know what? We're gonna agree, and it's weird, but I think it's beautiful too.
Yeah, and
do you have this?
I do. And I had Caroline Munroe autograph it. I was like thrilled to meet her. But I don't want to let our listeners think it's the greatest movie. It's not.
It's an unapologetic Star Wars influenced Italian film by Luigi Cozzi, who is a huge film fanatic, and he does all the effects in his movies, and also Luigi Cozzi also did a great alien ripoff movie called Contamination.
Yes, I remember.
Which,
yes.
So he kind of specialized in a couple like fun kind of ripoffs of better known American films.
And Ron, there's also like a lightsaber in it. It has these fighting robots, a bunch of them.
It's got Marjo Gortner in it.
It's also got
some TNA, which you know, at the time, let's face it, we were, you know, pubescent boys. We were.
She's
fat.
Caroline Munroe is wearing, through the entire movie, she's wearing a couple leather straps.
I have seen this.
And she is just.
Now you remember.
Now it's all coming back.
She
now,
is
right?
just stunning.
I would say, too, that Cozzi kind of was also a little bit influenced by Barbarella, because I think he was kind of combining Barbarella and Star Wars.
I would agree with you.
I know that Cozzi would have known that movie and been a fan of that film. So I think he was taking that sensibilities from that film and combining it with Star Wars.
I would argue it's more Barbarella than it is Star Wars.
Yeah.
And I would take Caroline Munroe over Jane Fonda any day.
I'll take them both.
Oh.
Depending on when.
Yeah.
And Larry, you said you didn't think it was a good movie, but
no, I do.
Part of the entertainment is the fact that you'd know it's a bad movie.
No, see,
you're watching it,
it's pretty ridiculous. Look, Larry, there's a scene where like the guys in like little missile ships,
my favorite,
through the glass of a space station, just.
Yes.
Open space day. They break the glass and they come out shooting.
Yeah. It's a missile. Imagine like a torpedo that crashes through in the vacuum of space.
Right.
You know, and two guys get out of the missile.
Sean, I think one of the reasons why I love it.
And it makes noise.
Maybe it was just, it was at a special time in my life. Know, and I remember the theater that I saw it, it was one of these cheap, like $2 or $3 movie places. It was like Meridian Quad, I think it was. And actually, the place was kind of packed. It was a Saturday afternoon, and it had a lot of kids in there. And we all were like enjoying it. And yes, I didn't think it didn't come close to Star Wars, but I still loved it.
Well, there's a charm to it.
It also benefited tremendously from having an A-list movie composer, John Barry, write the score.
I have that written down. John Barry did the music.
Which is rare for a movie like that.
Yeah, really. Totally.
And Christopher Plummer was an Academy Award nominee.
Well, I definitely want to see this again if I have seen it already.
Watch it directly after this.
Yes, he was wearing silver boots.
He never does wrong.
Yeah. He has some great, the way he delivers a line, Star Crash.
he is great.
Matt, would you agree?
He's great.
I mean, when he delivers the lines, and he knows, he probably did this in a day.
Obvious he did it in a day because the scene is him just like delivering the speech that goes on and on and on.
Yeah.
And that's a lot of him turning. And you can see, like, in his mind,
he's very majestic. He's great. You know,
he's wonderful.
I wanted to say one thing, too, about there's a great moment in Star Crash where Christopher Plummer's character, he's like the emperor of space or something. Yeah. It was a moment where, like, the enemies are defeating them, and he has this power. Just in the middle of the movie, he goes, "Stop the sands of time," or something. says this, and like time stops or something. Yeah. It's really bizarre.
It would have been helpful in the beginning of the film.
But also, the bad guy has a spaceship that's shaped like a giant hand,
like a claw. It's great.
And
it beats off another spaceship.
It does kind of curl. It kind of grabs, grab. But it's a wooden structure with all these model pieces and with a wire connected to the fingers, but still,
I do like it.
As long as we're on international Star Wars ripoffs, I think we should also bring up Message from Space from Japan.
Oh my god,
that's definitely
1978,
starring Sonny Chiba,
and
Street Fighter fame,
and Vic Morrow,
who's in everything.
I forgot about
and
that.
Directed by Kinji Fukasaku, who ended up doing
Battle Royale,
thank you.
And The Green Slime.
And
the classic The Green Slime.
One of my full-time favorites.
You've seen that?
Yeah.
Which you could say is also something that maybe Alien borrowed from. Aliens.
Yes.
Aliens. Yes. It's the story of aliens.
But it came before Aliens.
I know, but what I'm saying, I'm saying Aliens.
You're saying Aliens is a ripoff of The Green Slime?
I'm not seeing anything.
You're implying it.
You're the one who said it.
I would say Armageddon is a ripoff of The Green Slime.
There you go.
Armageddon?
Yes.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
It's the same exact plot.
There's
no creatures, but it's a planet for Earth, and they have to plant bombs all over the asteroid. The mission is exactly the same. There just happens to be green tentacled monsters in The Green Slime.
I think that's a pretty big thing to leave out, Sean.
But
it's
such a horrible movie, though, that it's not even worth comparing it.
No.
True.
Armageddon
being horrible? Yes. Yeah.
I would much rather watch Star Crash any day.
I'd rather watch The Green Slime.
And The Green Slime.
I have about four movies I want to see now, which is great.
On Message from Space, Toei Studios did it in 1978, and it is Gonzo. Janet Maslin, the New York Times film critic at the time, called it so terrible it has a certain comic integrity. Here's where
you memorize that too.
Just off the top of my head. Here you've got like a sailboat schooner type thing flying through space.
I do love that.
Yeah,
though.
You've got these effects. Apparently, it was the most expensive movie made in Japan at the time.
I'm so sorry.
No.
And this is also not to be confused with Toho's War in Space, which came out a year before.
Right.
Really rushed into theaters right after Star Wars.
So good.
Not as good.
But didn't Message from Space be a little bit kind of like The Seven Samurai, because there's these magical walnuts that the characters find, and when they find the walnut, that means they're destined to fight the bad guy. It's ridiculous. It's crazy.
James,
it's
crazy fun. Would you recommend Message from Space?
I think if you like sort of gonzo Japanese, like, you know, throw everything against the wall type.
It has all these dog fights.
Fascinated by it. I can't necessarily say that I love it, but I am fascinated by it.
Matt, I wanted to ask you something because I remember seeing previews for it on network television in Northern California. I wanted to find out, do you remember seeing those? The little...
I don't remember the previews, but here's what I do remember. Yeah. Is I remember going to the toy store and finding the model kits for it before the movie.
Wow, geez. Wow.
In American stores.
Did you go with your mom?
I did. She was there.
Yeah.
She carried me in. Right. She cradled me in her arms.
In Northern California, there was also a TV show called Captain Cosmic and Wonder Robot 2T2, and they would show clips of Ultraman and Flash Gordon and stuff. And I remember them showing a clip from Message from Space. And again, at the time, that was the whole reason for them putting that show on in the first place.
Oh, really?
Kids wanted science fiction stuff, you know? And I remember seeing that preview.
Wait a minute.
What?
Captain Cosmic is a Star Wars ripoff.
No. You know what? Captain Cosmic is a ripoff of something that came much earlier, Space Cadet, if you think about it. Because if you think about it, Space Cadet...
2T2?
What
Robot
about...
2T2.
Yes. Yeah. Well, but Captain...
2T2.
No, yeah, 2T2. Captain Cosmic and his Wonder Robot 2T2, which actually lives today in Santa Cruz, California, at the Atlantis Fantasy World comic book store in Santa Cruz. You could check it out.
Yeah. And still ripping off Star Wars.
No, well, no, Matt. No, he's there so people can come and he can still see him. He's still alive and kicking.
Our friend Kevin Kataoka once for my birthday gave me his original Captain Cosmic card, his membership card that he sent away for.
That's awesome.
When the show was on.
Yeah.
Wow.
So
useless to him.
So but so Matt,
a treasure to me.
So a friend gave you one?
Yes.
I have my original one.
Well, I used mine because I fucking cared about the show.
I cared about the show.
No, you didn't.
No, but you didn't even use yours. Get this. I'm gonna blow your mind. I'm gonna blow your mind. Are you ready for this?
Ready for this run?
I'm ready.
Okay, get this. And to our listeners out there, if you ever go to Santa Cruz, you go to the Atlantis. Listen, will you shut up for a second?
All right.
Santa Cruz, California.
This is mood music.
Atlantis Fantasy World comic book store. If you go in there to see 2T2, they will actually give you a new Captain Cosmic card, but you have to deliver the oath.
Okay.
They tell you what the oath is.
No. And two, who wants a new one?
Because they give out messages every week. You know, you could go
they
on,
give out messages.
Yeah, because what would happen is 2T2 would give out a little message.
Oh, I remember.
It would be
a little
decoder card.
I remember what the message is.
Okay. What was the message?
Watch TV.
No. that would have been good. This is the day I stopped using my Captain Cosmic card. Because you had a little, like, it could decode stuff.
Yeah, it could decode
stuff.
They give you a little code.
Yeah, and they give
7,
you a code.
3, 2, 4.
And I remember,
A is 1.
Yeah,
B
yeah,
is
think
2.
So. Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Not that linear,
not too far from that, no.
Yeah.
But what's your point?
So I remember, like, okay, I'm going to get the message. What's the message? And I decode the message, and the message was, robots love oily French fries. And I was like, I'm done. Wow. Goodbye.
Man,
I never saw this show, and I know that I wouldn't watch a show with a character called 2T2.
No, it's 2T2.
Oh, 2T2.
Yes.
Well, and the letter T.
And
the number 2,
and let me tell
letter
you something.
T.
What he's not telling you, Ron...
Because it's Channel 2.
No, and Ron, what he's not telling you is the robot's a real robot. It has real. It has a real electronic... lawnmower parts in him, and he moves and he lights up, so he's like a real robot.
Who's not telling me
so
this?
He
can actually mow a lawn?
No, the motor inside of it, but he actually has little early computer things in him, you know, and he
cool.
could do, he could,
right,
and actually
right.
he could
hey,
walk.
Wait a minute. So, going back to our gang comedies.
Yes.
And this is what I think, this is what?
Wow.
think Star Wars. Yeah,
I'm ready for this joke.
Are you ready?
Yes.
So, I think Star Wars ripped off our gang comedies.
No!
Yes.
And I'll tell you why.
What?
Okay,
the dog with the dot on his eye.
Right. Petey is
RTD2, is obviously
and it was a circle,
There was an episode where the bad kids, and these are the ones that had like Froggy and Mickey
right. And Spanky,
Yeah. The kind of shitty ones.
Alfalfa was not Alfalfa was not in the group.
Alfalfa was for a while. But then he left.
Right.
Yeah. And the only one left was Spanky, who looked he was like 45 at the time.
Yeah.
Right. But anyway,
hey guys,
so
let's go.
Yeah. So there was one where they go see a robot, and I believe it looks like Tobor.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
And they see this robot and they're like, "We're gonna build a robot." And so they build a robot, but the robot doesn't work. They just, you know, they just
put a bunch of stuff in
like cans together and everything, and put a bunch of
like
parts in it.
Like electric clocks
and
stuff,
they try to start it and it doesn't start because they're idiots. But then the bad kids come around and they go, "What you need is invisible rays." And so they they go, "We'll give you some and then your robot will work." And they have a shoebox that has nothing in it, right? And they sell it to the kids.
That's awesome.
And so like they have a job like, "We're going to go mow this lawn." And we go, "You don't have to mow the lawn. The robot will mow the lawn. But you have to give them the invisible rays." So they buy the invisible rays. Or no, at first there's a test. Like, "Well, how do we know this works?" Meanwhile, they didn't know the evil kid's friend snuck inside the robot.
Yeah.
And they give him a spoonful of the invisible rays, and he starts mowing the lawn and everything. But then he goes crazy and fucks up the lawn because, fuck our gang, right? So, of course, at the end, they find out, like Scooby-Doo, that it really was the kid inside the robot. And they learned a lesson. They should have done that work by themselves.
That is.
Yeah, which is really the message of Star Wars, isn't it?
No, Matt, I was going to say,
mow your own lawn.
Matt, that's right. Great, but that's how does that...
Tobar, by the way, is robot back.
I was gonna say, what does that have anything to do with Star Wars?
There was a robot.
Yeah, yeah. Hey guys, all right. If we're gonna talk about ripoffs, though, there's one incredibly influential movie in the 70s that spawned a lot of ripoffs, and that was Jaws.
Think about all the Jaws
ripoffs. Again, a thing where a cheap production could, you know, take just an element of just like a fin in the water, stock footage of a shark,
Jaws is about that killer shark and some severed
limbs in the water, and you got a movie. I mean, there was a whole onslaught of Jaws ripoffs. One of the most notorious was one from 1981 called The Last Shark, which was an Italian film. Here it was released as Great White.
Right. Oh, okay, okay. Because the title didn't.
Enzo Castellari.
With Vic Morrow again.
Yeah. And James Franciscus.
That's right.
James Franciscus was
in it. But I believe, James, you probably know this better than I do, but I think Universal Studios sued.
They did.
Right.
Yeah.
And they had the movie pulled from theaters, I think, right?
Because it was so blatantly.
It was like, Vic Morrow was Robert Shaw. James Franciscus was.
Brody.
Brody. Roy
Scheider.
It was so similar to Jaws.
Who was Richard Dreyfuss?
I don't know. Probably some Italian chick or something. I don't know if they had the Richard Dreyfuss
character. I studied the sharks.
But the amazing thing about this shark, though, is that like it didn't move like any shark you've ever seen.
It was
like this big plastic thing that just comes out of the water and it stays there. You know, it's this big head that's just floating. It's like, what is that?
Right, right.
But yeah, blatant.
No, but you're not.
Italian sharks are different, right?
they're a little more relaxed.
Yeah, they're relaxed and they're more plastic looking.
Yeah,
he's waiting for the pasta.
Sean, you're not recommending that, though.
Well,
are you?
I mean, if you're Jaws completist,
I kind of want to see this.
It is kind of.
I've never even heard of this.
It's entertaining.
It's entertaining. There's no question about it.
I remember the other title.
Gory.
I don't remember the first title.
Yeah, it was released here as Great White. In Italy.
This is one that I always saw, like, you know, Castle Films or Ken Films, they would release these Super 8 versions of stuff.
Yeah.
And there were a lot of titles I had never heard of, and they couldn't get the rights to Jaws, so there would always be something that was similar. So I always saw one that was like Mako, Jaws of Death.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which Mako, Jaws of Death was William Griffey directed. It was with Richard Jekyll. Harold Sakata, Oddball.
Demon booze!
In his class. That's what they called him in his class.
Yes, Oddball. It was Harold Sakata who played Oddjob in Goldfinger, and Richard Jekyll. And basically the movie was, William Griffey made a bunch of horror films in Florida, and one of the films he made was called Stanley, which is like guy
Oh
who,
my God,
who,
that who, one, holy fuck.
Yeah, it was the guy who was disturbed, crazy guy who like had his pet snakes
rattlesnake.
And basically Mako, Jaws of Death was like a shark version of Stanley. Richard Jekyll was the guy who loved sharks.
And he has a friend shark?
Yes, he does. He has a friend shark.
And Stanley was kind of a ripoff of Willard, wasn't it?
Kind of, you're right. Right. So it was like a ripoff of a ripoff. And it was Richard
and Willard
Jekyll
was a ripoff of, I would say, Psycho and the Birds.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. There you go. So it was multiple ripoffs.
Willard?
Levels.
Willard, yeah. With all the rats.
Where's the shower scene?
That's true. The
on
rats
the cutting
take
room
a shower,
floor, my friend.
You know, Sean, I wasn't gonna go straight with the shark, but to me, you know, Jaws came out in 75, a huge hit, and I was thinking everyone's trying to make the big sea creature thing. So to me, Orca I thought was a big. I know how James's much. I know how much James loves Orca.
I have a lot of respect for Orca.
I have to
you
say
have respect
that,
for Orca?
But that movie. Yeah. That movie is more like a Moby Dick tale than
it is. That's why I have
Jaws.
Respect for it because it really it's not isn't a blatant ripoff.
It really isn't. I mean, it may have been promoted that way.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's a pretty different movie from Jaws.
Right.
Whereas Tentacles, the Italian film from 1977, right. Was pretty much Jaws with
a lot of
with
big names in that one. Right. Too.
Oh my God, Tentacles! Somehow, they managed to get John Huston, Shelley Winters, and Henry Fonda in that movie. It's just a cheap Italian version. Wow.
I didn't
Jaws.
Know the yeah. film was going to be about this.
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
Can but, you imagine? Can you imagine making the pitch to Henry Fonda? He goes, "Well, I guess you know that Jaws thing was so big.
Yeah,
he
would
yeah.
do anything.
He would pretty much do
what
anything.
What about Piranha?
Yeah. Piranha is yeah.
Joe Dante.
I like Piranha though.
Sure,
which
I like
was
it.
Remade, yeah. right? That was remade.
It was remade.
Too.
It was kind of
Piranha 3D.
Sequels. Yes.
Piranha 3D. Which is a great movie.
It is? Yeah, I haven't seen that.
Oh,
yeah.
That is a lot of fun. Huh. Did you guys see that?
I have not yet seen not
Piranha
yet. 3D.
Was is badass.
Okay,
I
have to see
and
that one.
And Richard Dreyfuss has a cameo.
Really?
Basically playing
Hooper.
Hooper, yeah.
Wow. I did not know. Now I really want to see that.
But, yeah. but you know what? I want to see it in 3D, Sean.
That's true. That's true.
I mean,
but Piranha, I wouldn't say isn't that much of a Jaws ripoff, though, either. I think it was made because of the popularity
okay,
of
look,
Jaws.
Okay, look,
you don't think
look,
it's a Jaws
see,
ripoff?
Well, okay. it's Piranha that were genetically made to be more
okay.
ferocious.
Okay. This is what I want to tell you, though. Okay, you're saying, Orca's really, Larry, it's not really a ripoff. This is what I want to say. If it wasn't for Jaws... If it wasn't for Jaws,
sure,
Orca
not
would
made.
Not have been made.
And probably Piranha 2. I agree
right,
with you there.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah, that's true. They followed in the wake of its success.
Right.
Yeah.
Now,
true.
What about people who rip off themselves?
What do you mean?
Such as?
For example, Mighty Joe Young.
Hmm.
Okay.
Oh, that's good.
King
yeah,
Kong.
Yeah. That whole series.
Yeah. And that's Miriam...
Miriam C. Cooper.
Miriam
yeah.
C. Cooper.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, because
Willis O'Brien.
Yeah,
because they figured they play it safe and make another ape film, you know, so they kind of do another.
What kind
version.
Of a shittier one?
No, yeah. What do you mean shitty? Oh. It's not
shittier.
Well, it's not shittier.
Well, it's not on the level of King
no.
Kong.
Come on,
it's
King Kong.
Hey,
and it's kind of a you know. If it weren't for the special effects,
listen,
it's a snooze fest.
Okay, I actually really enjoy Mighty Joe Young a lot. And I as much as I
it's
love
fine.
King, listen, I love King Kong. And we're going to do a King Kong show. You know, and it's got dinosaurs and everything. But the animation's
great.
Of the gorilla. We know really 80% of it, maybe even 85, maybe not, was done by Ray Harryhausen, a young Ray Harryhausen, under the supervision of Willis
O'Brien.
Yeah,
and I don't care who did the animation.
Right.
The animation's beautiful, but it's a... lukewarm version of King Kong.
I still like it.
It's funny that I always side with Larry, but I
I'm delighted.
Without his mom involved, I think I like Mighty Joe Young. I think that was pretty
and
great.
I'm not saying
but
I
my memory of it as a child, though, not really now. I haven't seen it recently.
Well, you know, they did a remake, you know, with Charlize
right.
Theron, by the
right.
way, who
yeah.
I know
so?
How much you like her.
Yeah.
And Bill Paxton. And
okay.
And
I never saw it. No interest.
You didn't see it.
No
yeah,
so why would I
no
see a remake of Mighty Joe Young?
Well,
yeah.
I have seen that though. I think I have seen
Rick,
that one.
I mean, I think Rick Baker did a lot of the gorilla.
I'm sure.
So.
I'm sure the
you know,
effects
and
are great.
He was not in a costume, by the way, like he did in King Kong in '76.
This was CGI.
All, no. It, well, yes, there was some CGI, but there was also a lot of animatronic
okay,
and costume stuff.
Well, operating that gorilla though is an ape inside.
No.
I'm sorry that we've been
no,
bringing things back.
No, Ron,
yeah,
there's
sorry.
No ape inside.
And there's a dog inside that ape.
Right. Let's continue. I shouldn't have brought that up. I shouldn't have said that.
But look, that movie, I don't hate it. I like it.
I know.
But I don't, but it's
okay.
It's fine. It's a lukewarm version
it's
of
like,
King Kong.
Did they have to drink from the same well again?
You know,
right.
We did a show.
Right.
We,
with diminishing
right.
returns.
Right. You
right.
could argue the same thing
but
about Son
of Kong.
But isn't
Son of Kong also another
exactly.
one of those
exactly.
movies?
Well,
isn't that in the same
yes. That's a sequel. And that's,
it's a sequel.
And that's
oh.
not so good either.
Yeah.
I kind of have affection for Son of Kong.
As do I.
Again, I don't hate it.
Never trying to be the first Kong, but
yeah.
Well, along those lines.
Because it was rushed.
You could.
That's why.
You could argue that every Indiana Jones sequel since the first one was a ripoff of the first one because they were all diminishing returns.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
And then the first one could have been a ripoff of all the serials.
But now you're
too,
getting into sequel.
Homage.
Sure.
Homage.
Homage. Homage.
That is an homage because it turns it into something different, like Star Wars did with the Flash Gordon serials.
So Raiders of the Lost Ark is more of an homage to all those classic serials from the
30s. But giving it up
so, yes.
a big budget.
Yeah.
I think you guys might know this, though. Am I missing another gorilla movie? I feel like there was more than just those three.
Oh, there's more.
There's plenty. Right?
We're going to save that for our gorilla show.
No, we're not. Okay. No, we're not going to save.
Well, if you want a gorilla show, I'll shut up.
No, go ahead.
As long as it fits in ripoffs and wannabes.
I don't have nothing to say. I'm asking you guys.
Matt has nothing to say.
Mighty Joe Young, Son of Kong.
There was no King Kong.
Konga was later. That was 60s. Though.
Okay, yeah, no, but yeah. that's still a ripoff.
That doesn't count. No, I'm talking about the same era.
Same era.
I feel like there was another movie.
Oh, well, I don't know about that.
As far as stop motion animation, no.
No, you got him. You nailed it.
Okay.
That's kind of the three.
Speaking of primates, as influential as 1968's Planet of the Apes was, surprisingly few ripoffs and wannabes, although, Japan.
Oh, yeah.
They waited a few years. It wasn't until 1974, when maybe all the sequels had finally come out and were being released over there, that Tsuburaya Productions, who had done Ultraman,
Are you sure it was Tsuburaya?
Yes.
Yes, it was.
Yes, it was. Hmm. Sean is backing me up, so it's true. come out with a series called... What was the series called, Sean?
It was a TV series called Ape Corps.
Army Corps.
Wow.
Sandy Frank, who had brought over all the Gamera movies, strung together some episodes, dubbed it into English, and called it Time of the Apes here in the U.S. I don't know if this is something... Again, it's a gonzo Japanese show. I think I'd only recommend it to the curious.
I like it. I do.
It's ridiculous.
He's curious.
The redeeming factors for me... It's period. It's like, even though it's supposed to be far in the future because these people are frozen and wake up in the future, just like Buck Rogers.
Right, right.
Everything's 70s. So you've got these, you know, these wide lapel suits on apes. And these groovy, like, turtlenecks.
Yeah.
But talk about, like, cheap versions of, I mean, the ape makeup is pretty dire.
The mouths never move.
You can see.
Isn't it them trying to copy the ape makeup, but it's really not moving?
Really bad. Yeah,
it's really a mask.
You can see the actor's mouth talking inside the ape face. Like, it's terrible. It's really bad, yeah.
Try some spirit gum.
Exactly, yeah. It is kind of fun, though. I'd be curious to see the original TV series version in episodic form, other than
me
just,
too.
You know, I would love to see it somewhere.
Just that movie,
yeah,
right.
Totally.
You know,
and they made figures too. I have a couple. Yeah, so do I. We have a couple of little figures of the apes.
Sometimes when you see something and it's original.
We have one of the original actors upstairs in the box.
Only there's a dog inside.
Yeah. Kinji Takahura and Snoodles.
Okay, enough with the dog inside the costume.
Right. Why, your mother wouldn't want you to say... Come on.
No, but sometimes when you see something in its original form with subtitles, it gives it somehow a little bit more integrity than when you see it dubbed.
Yes, that's true.
Okay, guys.
I agree.
But what about, if we're talking about Planet of the Apes, what about the classic film Playmate of the Apes?
Oh, whoa. This is later, isn't it?
I don't know that one. Matt, I don't know this one.
I'm writing it down.
This is some hot all-girl action mixed with the Planet of the Apes story.
Are you serious?
That's right. Surefire hit right there.
What's the date on that?
The date is 2002.
2002.
And,
wow. Is this a porno?
I wanted it to be older.
I'm guessing it's softcore kind of.
It's soft. There's a lot of girl on girl action. It's mostly that.
With apes, come on.
But I mean, listen. But listen to the names of the characters, which is great. General Laid. Sergeant Jerko.
Oh, come on. What?
Yes, I'm telling you.
Oh, my.
And what's the rating on this?
Dr. Queera. And this is my favorite, Dr. Cornholius.
Fantastic.
They were having fun.
Yes.
They were having fun making fun of the names.
God forbid we have a good time.
This is only two writers that determined this.
Right. They had a lot of pull, though.
Well,
I
mean, would you recommend this?
I haven't even seen it, and I would recommend it.
The title alone.
I saw a trailer, and I was like, yes.
Okay, you know, for our listeners, I don't know. You know,
for our listeners,
you know,
I think they were like that.
Maybe it's not everyone's cup of tea, but if you like, you know, the human centipede, perhaps this is something that you would like to watch.
There's no comparison.
Yeah, there's no comparison.
Apes and centipedes? Come on.
The internet tells me that that it's around the same time as Planet of the Babes and shortly before the softcore comedy romp Planet of the Erotic Ape, which is just trying too hard.
Wow, that's true.
No, but you know what you got to love about these is that it's years since Planet of the Apes And yet somebody cared enough to still...
Right. Well, you know why. Because of the new one.
Yeah, Dawn of the Planet of the Apes.
That's No. Nope.
Oh, because of...
I'm talking like you again.
Oh, the Tim Burton one.
The Tim Burton one.
Oh, this is right, you're right.
And
you're
I take
right.
back what I said.
And that's to like a ripoff mentality there, too. Like, it's right? kind of trying right. to, you know...
Yeah. yeah. Well, and there's really a tradition in porn of doing that.
Of course, right, yes. Right.
And you got to give those plucky producers...
That's right.
And it's funny, if it was credit. In the early 80s, I would have preferred that. To see that movie.
Yeah, that's right.
2002 doesn't for some reason do it.
I have seen 10 minutes of Playmate of the Apes, and it's better than the Tim Burton version.
Well, Ron, speaking of the 80s.
Yes, Sean.
I want to mention a movie that very influential in that it spawned lots of imitators. Maybe not the greatest movie, but it spawned lots of ripoffs. And that would be Gremlins.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Gremlins spawned a series of series.
Yes.
Of
I didn't even think of that one.
Yeah.
So Gremlins came out in 84.
Yeah.
Huge hit.
Joe Dante.
And
Gremlins.
Soon after that, you got right. But soon after Gremlins, you got Critters, Ghoulies.
That's right.
Munchies.
Munchies, that's right.
Hobgoblins.
Yeah, wow. You're right.
And all those movies spawned several sequels.
Yeah.
And actually, I'm pretty sure I had read or somewhere that the first Critters movie, I think that was written before Gremlins actually came out.
And I prefer that. I prefer that to Gremlins. I'm not a Gremlins fan.
Yeah, Critters is pretty good.
Critters,
pretty scary.
I actually like the whole Critters series, to be honest. They're all actually kind of fun. Yeah.
I do like Gremlins. I just have one little issue about it, and I've seen Joe Dante talk about it, and kind of pisses me off because he thought it was funny, and that's when, you know, the girlfriend starts talking about her dad, you know, going down the chimney, and I mean,
Santa Claus, getting stuck in the. That's the one part I like about that movie.
You like that?
Yes.
That's horrible.
What I had read was that the original script by Chris Columbus was not the kind of Spielberg-y, fun, lighthearted movie that it was. This original script was a dark kind of horror film about actual gremlins killing people.
Yeah.
And that I would have loved to have seen that film.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I mean, this was a time when, you know, Spielberg. You know,
he was on fire.
Well yes,
my friend.
And I don't hate the movie, but it's just not really my cup of tea. Especially this sequel, Gremlins 2. It's forget it.
Yeah.
Gremlins 2, like, they break the fourth wall and they're making fun of the fact that they're even a movie. It's terrible. But whereas
neat Gremlin action. There's some neat Gremlin stuff in it.
I just don't care. But like,
I remember at the time. I remember kind of like, oh well, okay, they're making a comedy out of it, which was kind of what they were trying to do with the first one. But I felt like none of it ever worked.
No, and there is like a certain group of fans who like that's the kind of movie that if you're at the right age, that was a big kind of cool magical movie for you. If you're the right,
it's like Goonies too. Yeah, another like one. Yeah. Like everyone cites as their big movie.
Do you have any Gremlin figures?
No, I had no interest in getting Gremlin toys.
I have the original in the box.
Okay,
you know,
wow.
That's
great.
Gremlin.
That's great.
Yeah, once you open it up.
Can you keep it away from water?
Okay,
just let you know.
See what
Larry,
I did?
Larry, yes. What I do have, though, I have a Critters figure.
Do you have a Critters figure?
A recent figure that just came out, I think. Yeah,
no, I didn't know that.
But the Critters movies
are
fun.
More power to you guys.
Sean, is that the figure that has a toilet with it? Because it comes out of the toilet?
No, that's Ghoulies.
Ghoulies.
Get your Gremlins ripoff straight, Gonis.
You idiot.
Actually, James, I do have a Ghoulies.
Fucking embarrassment.
I have a Ghoulies figure coming out of the toilet signed by Charles Band.
Okay, that's
Comic-Con.
It almost broke up his marriage.
Sean,
amount of tail.
Sean, that is so freaking cool. That is so great.
Granted, the Ghoulies films are not that great, but there is kind of a charm about them. I would say the second one is actually a better film. Yeah,
I was just going to ask that. How much puppeteering do you think in each movie drove the movie? And kept the budget down for one.
Ghoulies is flat out almost Punching Judy. It's like that
really
shitty.
Right?
Totally. But actually, the first Ghoulies, the Ghoulies themselves are kind of secondary to the story. It involves a lot of like satanic stuff going on.
Oh, that's good.
But it wasn't until the second one that focuses completely on the monsters. Yeah. But then they made Ghoulies 3, Ghoulies Go to College, Ghoulies
that's
4.
That's not real, is it?
Yes.
Wait, did C. Courtney Joyner have anything to do with
it? Kevin McCarthy's in it.
Oh, that's right.
Oh, my God.
But then they made Ghoulies 4, directed by Jim Wynorski, and they stopped, I think, at 4, thank God. But they're pretty bad. And Munchie,
that's another reason for video stores.
Yes.
You would go in and you would see all, you would see there's five of them, and you would go, all right, let's start on one.
Yeah.
Or you'd get all of them.
Yeah.
One time.
Right.
Yeah. Right. The modern equivalent would be a Netflix queue, right?
Or like Netflix binge watching.
Yeah, binge watching the Ghoulies.
Right.
Series.
Yeah.
Now, Sean, has anyone seen that? Has anyone seen like five movies in a series in one place?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We all have.
Everybody
here.
All right.
Sean, Ron, I'm just talking
to the listeners.
Would you recommend? No. If you were to recommend to our listeners, out of all these Gremlins type ribbons, would you recommend?
I would say the Critters.
Critters, hands down.
1 through 3.
Hands down.
Yes. Or, I definitely say the Critters films are good. There's Critters 1, 2, 3, and 4. Critters 3 and 4 were written by our pal David Scow.
David Scow.
That's right.
And they're really fun. Don Opper's great. He's like the kind of alien guy who's trying to hunt down the Critters. And
Critters 1 is a really good movie.
Dee Wallace. And
but I do
Walsh.
Like them all, yeah.
Yeah, they're really fun. But yeah, Ghoulies, not so much. But if you have that low expectations, they're kind of enjoyable in their own kind of trashy way. Whereas Munchies and Hobgoblins, you could skip.
Yeah.
Does anyone approach those movies with a really high expectation?
That's true.
That's a very good question. You know why? Yeah. You know, it's interesting because, you know, I'd watch Critters and I would look at this movie and I'd go, this is fun. This is kind of a pretty nice little tongue-in-cheek kind of attitude to it. The story keeps moving. And then you kind of want to go, well, maybe I should see the whole series.
Mm. Right.
And
right.
you do.
Right. Because you have to.
Yeah. I mean, what about Tremors?
Oh, right. I love your. Well, but
and there's a lot of good Tremors movies.
Yeah, but are you
but
saying
I wouldn't say those are really
that's not a ripoff?
It's not. I'm not saying it's a ripoff.
That stands alone.
No, that does stand alone.
That is. Let us give respect to Tremors.
I love Tremors.
Michelle, yeah, me too.
Kevin Bacon and all.
And I love a lot of the sequels too.
Me too. Yeah.
There's an Old West one that's really good.
Yeah, they're all pretty good. But I would
say that's another show, isn't it?
Yeah, it is another show.
Let's start that one.
No.
Let's start that one now.
Right now, right?
Let's stick with ripoffs. Go ahead, Sean.
No, I was going to say, but like I said, movies
that have more than one movie. Okay,
yeah,
I'm sorry. Go
sequels.
Ahead.
Sequels.
Let's just make the topic movies.
Puppet Master.
Wait a minute.
That's
Puppet Master's not a ripoff.
No. I'm not saying that there weren't there. That's another self ripoff.
Well,
right?
I think
Demonic Toys.
Demonic Toys.
Yeah, Charles Band made a lot of like the Demonic Toys and Dollman and you know, all those kind of films were kind
Tim
of spawned from, you know, the small little even Ghoulies. I mean, Ghoulies, you know, the whole idea of making these cheap little puppet monsters that, you know, Full Moon Entertainment specialized in.
Yeah.
You know, a bunch of them. Yeah.
Well, and Trancers seem to be influenced, you know, at first glance by Blade Runner, a little bit Terminator.
Correct. Then it became its own kind of cool thing.
Right.
That's true.
Yeah. Maybe in the marketing.
Yeah. And that's a time travel thing, really.
It's not really Blade.
I mean,
not Blade Runner, a little bit Terminator, a little bit Blade Runner, but really its own thing. And the first one, you know, it's a fun series.
Hey, I'm just throwing this out here, but I know that there were a million knockoffs from RoboCop.
Mm-hmm. That was my next one. Terminator.
Do you know
Android Man?
Do you remember? Like, I can't really remember the names of them. I'm sure you've got them.
There was a few. There's one called Nemesis.
I remember that.
Tim Thomerson and Brian James are in it, actually. Mm-hmm. Mm. There's American Cyborg, Steel Warrior.
There you go.
That, I remember that one.
Cyborg Cop.
Yeah.
Hands of Steel, which involves like a guy with like, a robotic arm who does arm wrestling. There's
It's over the top.
Meets the Terminator. Yeah. There's Cyber Tracker with Dawn the Dragon Wilson. There's Future War with Robert Zadar.
There's a lot of them.
There's Abraxas with Jesse Ventura. There's a great one by Fred Olen Ray called Alienator. Get this cast.
That one I remember.
Ross Hagen, Jan Michael Vincent, PJ Souls, John Philip Law, Robert Clark, and a woman named Tegan Clive as a kind of female RoboCop Terminator chick.
That's an impressive cast,
yeah,
though.
It's a ridiculous movie.
I mean, that's got some decent people in there.
So there's a lot. Yeah.
Eliminators?
What is that one, Sean?
Eliminators?
Eliminators?
Eliminators is the one with Denise Crosby.
Yeah.
That's kind of more.
There's a robot guy
there. That's the mandroid.
But
mandroid.
Kind of in the same way that.
You know
like,
what we're talking about, Ron.
There's also one
the
called Android Man.
Oh, yeah.
Android Man?
Okay, possibly. Yeah. I have to look that one up.
I don't know what. I can't remember the title, but I can't remember who's in it or anything. I swear, it's Android Man.
But Sean, the one that you were just saying that had the amazing cast in it, which one was it?
Mandroid?
No.
It's not Mandroid. It's Android Man, I think.
Okay. Did Mandroid have anything to do with Eliminators? No.
Well, no, but there was, I think they called the guy.
They called it a
Mandroid,
right?
But much like in the same way that.
Because he was half. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
But
he needs to say this because maybe our listeners won't understand.
You know, you have a good point, Ron.
He's half man.
Continue.
And half mandroid.
No.
So wait a minute. So he's mamandroid?
So he's two-thirds man and one droid.
I thought he would be like,
but inside he's an ape.
Inside.
Why does the ape keep coming
up? I wouldn't bring that back anymore, but I'm glad you did.
He's a one-man love triangle.
Yeah, he's right, half man right. and half robot. Come on, let's. What's it called?
Mandroid.
No. Mandroid. That's it.
Android,
exactly. Mandroid. Right.
Oh, there was a movie called Android.
Yes.
With Don Opper and Klaus Kinski.
Yes.
That's
yes.
a good movie.
Yeah,
I remember
yeah, that is a good movie. Yeah.
It's good.
No, it's a good movie.
No, that's a good movie. Yeah.
I remember having issues.
Say
with
was that?
It,
huh?
But I remember having issues.
What are your
Where
issues?
We draw the line
it's a
with
smart
Cyborg.
Movie.
What about Cyborg?
Well, Cyborg was more kind of martial arts action and post-apocalyptic. It wasn't right. as much Terminator. I got you know a little bit, I guess. But what's interesting is that in the same way that the Italian film industry combined Escape from New York and a Road Warrior, they also combined Terminator with RoboCop in their ripoffs too. It was they're just like
right.
combining all of them together.
Sure,
hit as many bases as you can.
Right? Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Well, and speaking of Terminator, you know, that's also has been often mentioned, influenced by a couple of Outer Limits episodes written by Harlan Ellison.
Right, that's true.
Soldier and Demo with a Glass Hand.
Right, and yes. I think there was like some kind
a
of
lawsuit.
Suit, and they settled by mentioning Harlan Ellison's
name. Yeah, they
name,
gave him a credit.
Credits. Right, right. But now that's kind of
I'm sure there was
more in the
bucks.
Lines of like plagiarism as opposed to like a movie company
yeah,
trying to like
yeah,
right. But
because
yes.
I thought no one would remember or,
right, right. Yeah. That's true, that's true.
Well, they thought wrong.
How about this one? Tell me where this one lies.
Okay.
The movie Megaforce.
Oh my God, Megaforce.
Which is kind of Mad Maxy.
It totally is.
The story really isn't.
No, but
story?
But the story is so there's two countries. You know, there's the nice one and then there's the evil one.
Yeah.
And they're having this battle. But so they have to call upon this elite force, Megaforce, led by yeah. Barry Bostwick.
That's right.
With
in spandex.
In spandex yep. and the most coiffed hair you've ever
he
found.
Looks
in
his
a
hair
wasteland.
Was great. He looks like a BG, basically.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you know, that's what I thought was really cool because I wanted my hair like that at the time.
Really?
I wow. did. I did. I did. Wow. I wanted my hair to be kind of BG like in
and
a
your
way.
Your mom said no.
No, she let me do. And did you guys have Angel Flights pants? Did you guys do that at that time?
Well, okay, no.
What?
You're pulling my leg.
No.
Now.
This come on.
No.
Okay, getting back to Megaforce. We'll save this for another show.
Wow.
No, I'm learning so much.
I actually have
a question for Sean, the director on that.
Yes. Okay, Megaforce was a notorious bomb that came out in 1982, directed by stuntman turned director
yes.
Hal Needham.
Okay, now I...
He had a lot of success with Smokey and the Bandit films, a couple other films, and they thought, you know, he can do no wrong. Let's make a big budget sci-fi action movie called Megaforce.
Yeah. Didn't they even have a sequel slated, like ready to go?
I think
maybe,
so.
Yeah, maybe.
Guys, this is really funny. I remember watching Entertainment Tonight... And the movie was about to
it
be released.
It was promoted a lot.
And I wanted to see this. And Hal was being interviewed. And they
really?
Asked him about, well, how do you feel about, I mean, didn't you want to sex up and make a rated R film? And he said, I will never make a rated R film. Because I want
really?
Everyone
oh,
to see
those,
you know. And I said, that's awesome, man. I want to see this film.
It was supposed to be like this the
he
elite
did a
force
it was PG,
of vehicles,
yeah.
and he designed all these yeah. vehicles. And it was like, and the cast, it was Barry Bostwick, it was Michael Beck, fresh from Xanadu.
Persis Kambada.
Persis Kambada.
Yeah, Persis Kambada, that's right, with hair.
Edward Mule hair was
wow.
in it.
Mm-hmm.
And, Henry
funny,
Silva.
Now I know what movie mm-hmm. you're talking about.
did you see it in the theater?
I don't think so.
Yeah. I saw it in the theater.
You would have remembered it.
Yeah. As soon as I saw his hair, I was done. It was out.
Yeah,
it was like,
what do you mean you were done?
I was done.
His hair looked great.
It was laughable.
No.
It was goofy.
Megaforce.
His hair looked ridiculous.
See, here's the thing that gets me about you guys, is you guys think, oh, looking back at it with spandex and fluffy hair. You know, back then, Matt, I bet you thought that was so cool.
Wait,
that
Larry, no. are you defending Megaforce? You like
Larry, the movie itself was terrible.
I know, it is. It's not a great film, but I'm saying
it's a horrible film.
I know, but I liked
defending his hair.
The hair, you know.
Not to say that I don't have it on DVD and like to watch it, but it is a terrible movie.
No, it's like, it's one of those where if you're really in a goofy mood.
Yeah. It's a train wreck.
But as soon as I saw him with his coiffed hair and his spandex and that motorcycle, I was like, what?
The floating motorcycle.
But look, yeah.
Look, but getting back to, would you say, though, that was because of the popularity of the Mad Max films? Is that a ripoff? Or?
I do think that it was... tangentially linked.
I would agree. I'd actually agree with Matt. And look, guys, I'm not saying, hey, listeners, go and see it. I'm just, you know, the guy had great hair.
you know? and I defy you to I'd love to see you guys back then. I bet you really thought the spandex looked pretty cool. I mean,
nope.
There were men that wore spandex. Not heavy glam metal band, which is fine, because that's appropriate.
If Megaforce had been released around the time of the Buck Rogers TV series, I think it would have gotten a little bit more of a pass because, it's of the time.
Yeah.
And then the spandex would have seemed a little bit more maybe, I don't know, okay, trendy.
Yeah, it was like a disco version of the Road Warrior.
Five years too late. Because by that time, that summer, 82, we were going to see The Thing. We were going to
I think it's one of those things, if the film had come out a little earlier, maybe it would have.
Maybe.
4 years maybe. Earlier, it might have, yeah.
And then we would have had a whole slew of sequels and ripoffs of Megaforce.
I just think you guys are a little too harsh on the spandex and the coiffed hair.
I don't think you're harsh enough. I think something happened in your childhood that put you on a weird path. And I'm here to talk to you about it whenever you want.
Ron, what do you think?
I have to note that I think probably every show, The Thing comes up at some point.
Yeah.
We love
Am
The
I
Thing.
Right?
You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know.
Right?
That
no,
show,
but
that,
we love
that
it.
Would take place in almost any topic.
Yeah.
Between remakes, or it's not, there's no wannabe involved there, I don't think.
There is, though.
But there is,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
there
we know what that is, don't we?
H.P. Lovecraft.
H.P. Lovecraft. I wasn't going to say that, but that's.
Yeah,
that's what I think.
The original story that The Thing was based on, Who Goes There, by John W. Campbell,
right,
was a contemporary of H.P. Lovecraft.
Oh.
And a lot of people seem to think that he was very much influenced by H.P. Lovecraft. Because if you look at that original story, and if you look at John Carpenter's The Thing, very Lovecraftian.
Well, yeah, that's interesting because the Howard Hawks movie, obviously, they didn't have the budget to make a Lovecraftian
monster.
They couldn't
do that.
So
but
it's, like
it's that film is still great.
No, it is a great movie. But it's very different, but I love it.
But it wasn't until the 80s when they had the technology to do the kind of effects that they do in the Carpenter's film that it does have a very Lovecraftian feel. You're right.
Because all the stuff in the original book is in... I mean, it's not shot for shot or anything like that, or scene for scene from the original story, but this is a creature that can take on... You know, the shape of something else.
Yeah.
And anything alive, really.
What is the story called again?
Who Goes There?
Who Goes There?
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, I think he was influenced, but it's okay because it's its own thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm so happy that that story exists because it gave us one of probably my favorite films of all time.
Yeah. You know, I'd agree, but you wouldn't call that a ripoff. I mean, I don't think that's fair.
You know what? I'm not.
Yeah.
What I'm really just saying is it's for the sake of argument.
Okay.
Some people kind of do think that.
No, I don't see that, though.
I think that you can be influenced by another writer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that Lovecraft was influenced quite a bit by Poe. And I don't think that's necessarily a ripoff because he created a whole different world than Poe ever did.
Yeah,
right.
Poe's stuff was all kind of like
psychological.
Psychological.
Yeah. Right. But we're gonna say
and
that
Lovecraft created this pantheon of creatures, and
a
monsters,
whole mythological. Kind
we're gonna
of world.
save that for our Poe episode though.
Why are we saving everything? we're gonna say. Oh, we're talking about cheese.
Stop talking.
That's the cheese episode that's coming. All right, so what should we do? Should we do like
I mean,
a kind
there's so many. We can keep going and going. But
I do want to just circle back a little bit and just rapid fire mention a couple more Alien ripoffs. We mentioned Galaxy of Terror and Forbidden World.
Yes.
And Seminoid with Judy Geeson and Stephanie Beecham.
Oh, Judy Geeson.
Judy Geeson is impregnated by an alien and she goes crazy and aliens pop out of bellies and it's great.
Okay.
The Terror Within with Andrew Stevens and George Kennedy.
Oh, yeah.
Corman film.
Yeah, I remember that one.
And there was a Terror Within 2, which Andrew Stevens directed, and his mom, Stella Stevens, was in it. there was one called Creature, also known as Titan Find, with Klaus Kinski. William Malone did that one.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
There's a ridiculous one called Unknown Origin with Ry McDowell and Melanie Shatner and Don Stroud.
I don't know that one.
Dead Space with Mark Singer. And how about the... Remember when The Abyss came out?
Yes, yes, yes.
There was kind of these hybrid Abyss slash Alien ripoffs.
Yeah.
Same year, came out. Deep Star 6, directed by Sean Cunningham, with Greg Evigan, Miguel Ferrer, and Nia Peoples. The same year, you had, actually, I think the better film, Leviathan,
yeah.
By George Cosmatos, who directed Stallone's Cobra. That had Peter Weller, Richard Crenna, the delicious Amanda Pays, Daniel Stern, Ernie Hudson, and Meg Foster. And that was kind of a fun one. That was better. That was actually a little bit more of a thing ripoff, too, because it was kind of like they were getting...
There was a morph.
I forgot all about them. That's great.
They're both kind of fun films, and those are kind of quintessential 80s monster movies.
Yeah.
But definitely influenced by The Abyss, The Thing, and Alien. A little bit of all those.
Well, jumping in about water alien ripoffs... Deep Blue Sea, which came years later.
A mixture.
It's shark exploitation and alien exploitation.
That's true.
Little by little, everybody who's sequestered on this lab,
underwater
the sea
lab,
gets eaten one after the other.
That's true. I mean, the 80s was, you know, that was a time when you had a lot of different, like, animatronic practical effect monster movies, you know, whether it was from Gremlins or Alien or The Thing, but that was like a prime era for that kind of stuff, you know.
Well, and I know that we've talked about this. I mean, I don't want to spend too much time, but you know, The Exorcist from 74.
That
was
my
huge.
Other one.
It was huge.
We touched upon that.
We did.
Right.
We did. I don't want to go into it, but that The Exorcist was also ripped off.
Oh my God!
So many.
Let me tell you. Beyond the Door.
Abby.
The Sentinel. Yeah. The Manitou.
Yeah.
The Antichrist.
Yeah.
There's tons.
There's so many. I mean, The Extra stands alone as the best.
Right.
You know,
but another example, though, where, like, you could just take, you know, an innocent-looking girl or kid and just have some, put some makeup on, do some sound effects, and you have an exorcist movie, you know?
Around.
Yeah, like, it was kind of an easy movie to imitate and rip off.
Especially for again, Turkey, where they just imitated it word for
word. That's right. It was called Satan, I think. S-A-Y-T-A-N.
Were there songs?
There should be. I don't know, maybe.
Well, look, the last one I want to do, Sean, is now, I know you guys are going to jump all over me on this one, but... This film was very successful, and it spawned a film that I absolutely despised, okay?
Interesting.
Okay. We're talking about 1982, the film that I loved, E.T. the Extraterrestrial.
Right.
Great. We talked about it. Some of you guys felt it was an overrated. But it spawned this film in 86 called Mac and Me.
Oh, my God. That movie. 88,
okay,
I think.
And I want to tell everyone, listeners, do not see this film.
Wasn't that movie like...
It's like a kid in the wheelchair.
But wasn't it like a 90-minute commercial for McDonald's?
Yes.
Because it was partly funded by McDonald's.
Yeah.
So there are scenes where they're just going to McDonald's and eating Big Macs.
But imagine instead of, you know, little Elliot and E.T., now you have a little kid in a wheelchair. There's this famous scene. I think you can look it up on YouTube. It's like famous Mac and Me wheelchair scene where the kid he's in his wheelchair and he rolls down this cliff.
Does
the alien save him or something?
The funny thing is, you think, oh, so is the alien going to stop him like midair? It's like, no, the kid actually goes off the cliff and lands in the water. And the alien, Matt, you would hate it. The look, he has these big bulging eyes.
It was like an E.T.
And it made me angry. I was yelling.
But you know what? You know what? Speaking of that, you know what makes me angry?
What's that?
Is that, so that was at the time. Now we've got years later, speaking of E.T., bullshit like Super 8, which is this warmed over trying, you know.
I agree. When I saw that, I thought, like, you know, you're right. That was like J.J. Abrams.
That was J.J. Abrams.
His version of
Spielberg movie.
Right. Yeah. And not as well.
But it was just...
I'll take E.T. over that one any day.
I agree. It was just soulless. There was never a real moment in that movie. It was so, so manufactured.
And then cut to now, we've got the series... Stranger Things that everyone seems to love.
Yeah.
Granted, I've only seen an episode.
I saw one episode, the first pilot. Yeah. I thought it was not bad, though.
What? But, you already saw E.T. Why do you need E.T. again?
When I saw,
and then
I thought,
horrible Winona Ryder vomiting on the screen.
I
don't think there's a comparison to those two
things. Granted, I've not seen the rest of the series, but I will take the pilot of Stranger Things any day over Super 8.
I agree.
I mean, I think it is a better, just that first episode to me is way better than Super 8.
And you would take E.T. over any of that.
No, I agree that
I'll take E.T. over Stranger Things.
God love you, man.
Really?
Yeah, God
really.
Love you.
Yeah. I mean, Stranger Things is, what is interesting about that? I don't get it. I don't understand the fascination of that series. You've got E.T. Well, Why do you need a bad version of it?
Because, Matt, maybe, I'm just going out on a limb here. Maybe, Matt, it's not meant for you. Because it's
that
meant for and I we're you know, we were around in the 80s. We saw E.T. I loved E.T. You know, I cried at E.T. Now, you know, it's many years later. These kids today, maybe there's like, okay, they're not as aware of E.T., and so this is something different.
Well,
so,
yeah, but instead of a cool alien, a cool animatronic alien, now I've got a telekinetic girl
but a missing kid? Give the show a shot. You've seen one episode. You don't know what's going to happen. I mean, it's setting up a lot of stuff.
But all the stupid... It's so obvious that they're trying to make this... Again, it's the idea of an homage to something. Right. I don't want an homage.
Well, I totally agree with Sean. The fact that you're not even giving the show a chance by watching one show.
I think it's eight episodes.
First of all, I agree with you a little bit.
Yeah, I'm not saying.
I think the show is pretty derivative of many, many other shows.
You know what show reminds me of already, though? It reminds me of a show called Erie, Indiana.
Yes.
Which is a show, I think Joe Dante produced it, and it was kind of the same thing. It was 80s kids in suburban neighborhood, and they come. It was like the X-Files with like suburban kids and bikes.
Okay.
But I'm just saying that, like, you know, I'm intrigued by Stranger Things. I do agree that there's been
what
so
other
much...
things intrigue you? I want to know.
There's been so much.
While you're on that though, I mean there's like a scene that's like Stand By Me, and they're walking down the railroad tracks.
Yes,
you know, and then there's another scene. You go, well, this is from something else.
Well, yeah. that's all I'm trying to say is if this is their pilot episode, and I understand that a pilot can be a little bumpy sometimes, but when something throws me off so much, where I go, oh, that's a ripoff of that. That's a ripoff of this.
Yeah.
That, like,
there's so
why
many.
Don't
and
you?
How is that not an homage?
No.
I'm just being
exactly.
Advocate.
That's a good
here.
Argument. Yeah. I think it's a matter of opinion.
See, if
right. you, I think
if,
so too, right?
If you came away from Super 8 like Matt did and like I did and Sean,
yeah, it's
I guess,
just it's soulless.
Then you're almost shell shocked.
It is.
You're almost shell shocked into seeing Stranger Things and saying, "Oh, wait a minute, that's just that's preying on the nostalgia of our generation for movies from 1982."
Yeah. Well, they're doing it again. They're going to try this one again.
Well, yeah,
I already think though that Stranger Things is in better creative hands than Super 8 was. So I'm not saying, like I said, I've only seen the first episode. I do agree that there has been so much gushing over this new show. I mean,
right.
I was here. I swear, like from 12 different people, like, you haven't seen Stranger Things.
No,
oh my!
No.
This
what
is
about
the second
Winona
coming
Ryder?
Of. Mind her. She's just. I mean,
are you kidding?
What is it about her that you don't like?
She's terrible. She's how old and she still talks like a valley girl?
You're talking about the girl?
She didn't bother
Winona
me.
Ryder, the mom.
Winona Ryder,
I'm not saying she should win an Emmy, but like, I mean, I'm intrigued by the mystery
in
the show.
I'm not going to give her a razzie.
Hey, he's intrigued,
The show is already, it looks like it's going to be darker than Super 8 and anything. So, an E.T. for sure. So,
darker?
It's going to be dark. I mean, yeah, there's the guy gets shot in the head by the conspiracy people. And
okay, that's
fine.
Pretty
it's,
dark.
It's going to be, look.
I'll give it that.
We'll do our special Stranger Things episode.
We're
going to
do our
talk about the series.
You know what? I will do this. Because of you saying this, I will give it another chance. I'll watch another episode.
Yeah, I mean, like I said,
two.
I don't know where it's going.
I'll watch two.
Yeah, two.
I'll watch two.
I think
I'll
there's only
two.
Eight. I think there's
right.
only eight episodes.
Out of all the stuff we did today, I think you're going to get more comments on this.
You may be right. Yeah.
Well,
there's so many people into that show.
I know.
It's true. You're right. No, you're right.
But look, I could be wrong, and I'm going to give it another chance.
But I have a question for Larry. Mac and me, okay? when you saw Mac and me.
Yes.
Did you see it in a theater?
Yes.
Wow.
By the time
why?
By the time you bought that ticket,
you know, you listen.
Larry, by the time you bought that ticket, didn't you already know that it was a shame?
This was 1988.
Yes.
You already
it was.
Knew.
1988.
Were
yes.
you just like coming from McDonald's?
Hey,
and really
listen.
Hungry and
okay, first of all.
And Larry, I'm not picking on you, but.
Yes,
but
you are.
No, I'm just trying to equate, because when I saw Mac and Me come out, just sort of like when I saw Battlestar Galactica come out, I'm like, okay, that's just a ripoff. I'm not going to bother with it.
Right.
But you went to the theater and paid
yes.
to see it.
Yes. Yeah, well, first of all, it played at a cheaper theater. I didn't have to pay. No,
my mom paid for it.
Okay. Hey! Very funny. Very funny.
Happy
no,
birth.
I was working. Okay. Listen. Listen, at the time, I happened to work at a movie theater.
Okay.
And
okay,
one cool. of the benefits right. that I got
as getting to see Mac and me.
No, listen, the benefits is you got to see movies for free.
And what you
had to do is you called up the other theaters and they would let you go for free. So there was a time for a period for 3 years, I saw just about everything. And I thought to myself as this great, you know, like movie critic kind of, and I always felt whatever film you see, stay with it because no one goes out of their way to make a bad film. And I have to tell you though, I was really tested on Mac and Me.
I like the fact that you actually used up a favor to go see Mac and Me.
You know, and
the porn version's good though.
You know what? No, I'm no,
Macking on me.
No, Matt. I want to now listen before you jump all over me here. But I want to just throw this out at you. People forget that it was directed by a guy named Stuart Raffel, and he also did The Philadelphia Experiment and Ice Pirates. Back in
two great movies.
Now, Ice Pirates, you know, was kind of
Ice Pirates is really stupid.
It was kind of silly and stupid, but I thought they'd be more funny. No. I'm just
it's
saying,
funny.
You know, and the guy's still working today, so you know.
Oh, then it's great.
Well,
then
the Mac and Me remake.
Larry, you're being picked on way too much.
Yes, because you guys are missing the point. I'm saying it was a ripoff of E.T. I did not like the film. There were ridiculous stuff. So it's like I don't know why you're jumping all over me because I went to see it.
You're a very easy target.
Yes.
However, that said, I think when you get to see a free movie, why not?
Why not?
But calling right? like, hey, man, look, I know we're not supposed to do this, but look, I need to see Mac and Me.
We could go on and on.
We haven't even got
wrong. I'll let you in to see E.T. if you let me in to see Mac and Me.
Wow. There you go. Yeah. There you go.
Anybody else got some other things here?
Nutty Professor.
Yeah?
Okay, I'm kidding.
it is kind of a ripoff.
It's Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Yeah. Right. It's very
true.
Although it's got the comedy twist. I don't necessarily think of it as a ripoff though.
Yeah.
You know the whole big thing. We never even got to Star Trek, really.
Mm. Yeah.
And Star Trek, the ripoff, this is sort of a controversy, which is so there was Star Trek Deep Space Nine, one of my favorite shows.
Yeah.
And Babylon 5, which I also really like.
Mm-hmm. Me too.
Yeah.
But there was this controversy
that
Deep Space Nine was ripped off from Babylon 5.
Oh.
Yes. Originally, Michael Straczynski pitched this to Paramount.
Right.
It was like a very short time before Babylon 5 was going to air that they aired Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Right.
And he feels that although it's not exactly like Babylon 5, that they took his series Bible that he left and kind of used it to create this show and then tweak it to make it not too similar.
You know, it's hard to say exactly because at the time, if you recall, Deep Space Nine was one of several ideas that was, I think, proposed as possible spinoffs. Mm-hmm. Deep Space Nine was the one of, I think there were several. I don't know the exact amount, but that was the one that was chosen. I don't know, Matt, if it was
if it were you.
Okay.
You are J. Michael Straczynski.
Okay.
And you go to Paramount and you pitch this show.
Yeah.
They decline it.
Yeah.
And then not too long after, they announce their new show, which is about a space station where all these different races come and intermingle.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I just...
Yeah, it's. I mean, I can definitely see that as a possibility, but you know,
Not entirely out of the realm of possibility.
But you get other writers to change it enough.
Well, and as someone who watched both shows all the way through, and I do like them both,
right?
Mm-hmm.
And they are very different. I feel in tone,
yes, and in ideas too,
in ideas.
Mm-hmm.
But initially, and I'm sure J. Michael Straczynski was watching the original seasons. And
sure,
going,
right, right.
There may have been some similarities, but it's not as clear to me as like E.T. and Mac and Me. I mean, that's just a slam dunk, a blatant
ripoff.
Yeah, right. I mean, you know, the idea is that you've got a space station. Really, I mean, that's the main thing.
The
characters within the show aren't similar, I would say, at all.
Yeah.
But,
except for Deep Space Nine, they're both pretty good.
Wow. Oh, you're a Voyager guy, right? I'm so sorry.
What? Don't be sorry. I love Voyager, too.
Come on. Like, I can almost prove scientifically that that's a shitty show.
Okay, you know what?
That wouldn't be fun, would it?
Listen, we're not going to spend time in our ripoff show
Thank you, Larry.
Jumping into the Star Trek thing.
Thank you, Larry.
Okay, you're welcome, sir.
Thank you, Larry.
Now let's get
you
back.
You know what
to...
I like is this show has brought so many different alliances and friendships.
It really has.
It is. And I've learned something. I've learned to maybe give a show a second chance to not jump. Yes.
Well,
Shawn Sheridan here.
One episode. I watched a little more.
Wait a minute. How many times have you watched one episode and went, fuck this?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. And my wife would attest to that too, because she sticks with stuff a lot more than I do. Like I get impatient. Yeah, but
and also, isn't there something to be said for you watch a pilot and it jabs you in a place that you don't like,
right?
And so you're like, oh, I'm not gonna be fucked over again.
Well, I'm worried though that you're already predisposed to hate Stranger Things now, because you're just gonna shit all over it.
Sean, he's sincere.
I'm telling you. We watched it hoping everything that I watch, I never go into something expecting it to be terrible.
Right, right. Okay. Yeah.
Unless I'm dragged to it. I knew the Tarzan movies was going to... I knew the new Tarzan
movies.
Did you see that? We're talking about that one that came out this year.
Yeah. Right, right. I mean, sure, I can see that. Right.
When I visit, we go to Arkansas and visit Carrie's parents there. And they always drag us to a movie, and it's always terrible. So the last time it was Tarzan.
Right, it's got
to
be something they want to see as well.
Yeah, the time before that was the first Spider-Man reboot, which was awful.
Dreadful.
Yeah, but even that, I kind of go, well, maybe I'm wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know. Interesting to see next time we get together.
So you're saying
the Stranger Things.
I wanted to like it.
Yes.
I feel like, much like what Spielberg does in movies sometimes that I resent, when I feel like someone is jabbing me to get me to feel something that they haven't earned yet.
Right, right.
That's where I kind of check out a little bit. But maybe I'm wrong.
Admittedly, I'm there with Stranger Things, because I kind of, after two episodes, went, no, this is totally derivative of everything. And then I went, but I want to see what happens.
But you kind of like it. Okay.
I kind of want to see what happens with that show, you know? Right. It's a great cliffhanger show in a way. It always ends in a way where you have to find out what's next.
And now, you feeling that,
which is manipulative, but it's
but
okay.
Do you get to a place where you go, I know what you're doing and I don't mind it? Like that kind
of
thing?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think that's part of it. Sure. I know what they're doing. I know exactly what they're doing to me.
So Matt's learned to maybe give things a second chance in this ripoff stuff.
I've learned how much I really love Shawn Sheridan.
He's
like in my head.
I think we can all say that. I learned that, which I didn't know, that the little computer thing around Tweaky was Greek. I didn't know that.
Marvelous,
yeah.
True.
But I think there are plenty of ripoffs and wannabes out there.
There are others. Yeah, we'd like to hear from our listeners too.
What
some
do you
other
think?
Ones that you guys can come up with.
Oh, this has been great.
Yeah.
Really has been.
I agree.
Thank you.
And
thank
Ron,
you, Ron.
Thank
Thanks,
you for
Ron.
That, enduring
this. So we're ending
this.
Now, right? This is the ending thing?
This
where
is
I,
kind of
like,
You don't have to say that you had a good time or anything like that. Okay. But we loved having you.
This
and
is the best podcast I've ever done.
Yeah!
Oh, yeah.
In a
Take
way,
that
I'm,
other
I'm
podcast.
You fed me. You fed me drinks, which I don't. I haven't drank alcohol in probably 12 years now.
So we've kind of ruined your life a little bit. That's good.
Yeah, but you know, nothing wrong with that.
No. We've learned, believe me, that's what we live by.
Ron, Sobriety is overrated.
Is there anything you got going on you want to let our listeners know about?
I do a show every Saturday evening at midnight at the Steve Allen Theater in Hollywood.
Ooh, cool. Oh.
Yes.
It's kind of a variety show, but there's also themed shows. And we have our gigantic anniversary show on the 17th of September, which has many famous people on it.
Awesome.
Like?
I don't know yet. Not really.
Ron Lynch.
Well, yeah.
For one.
Me,
I love that show. I love your show. I mean, honestly, it's my favorite show. It's my favorite show in L.A.
It's super fun.
It's super fun. Because what's great is that it's... Yeah, you can have stand-up, but you encourage people to do whatever. It can be a variety act.
People can do whatever they want. Anything. I don't tell people anything. And there's always music. There's always music on the show.
Cool.
Of some kind.
Ron, where can people go to like find out about this stuff? Is there a website or something?
They can call me directly at 323-555.
Or you can just go over to his house. The address is... No.
There is a tomorrow... ! Site on a page on Facebook, it's called, I think.
Okay.
And you can find me on Facebook as well.
great.
Follow him. Follow him.
I have a website. I have the ronlynch.com, but there's absolutely nothing there.
Right. I've been paying under construction.
I've been paying for that name for probably 8 years now.
Awesome.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
We can find you on Friendster.
Friendster,
MySpace.
Yeah, Friendster, MySpace. MySpace. Oh yeah, MySpace.
MySpace.
Yeah, yeah. MySpace?
No. See, they're outdated. See what I was doing?
Yes.
Okay. Let's start the show over again.
Anyway, I thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was awesome.
And I cannot recommend the Tomorrow Show enough. If you're not living in Los Angeles, come to Los Angeles.
And if you visit,
and who's
see the
doing
Tomorrow
anything
show
at midnight on Saturday?
Thank you. Yeah, it's a midnight show. How great is that? How cool
awesome
is that?
Yeah,
cool.
That's cool.
And always surprising, always fun.
Hey, time for a listener shout out.
Shout out!
Shout out.
This goes out to Chrissy Myers out of Toronto, Ontario.
Chrissy Myers!
Chrissy Myers. A photographer, a podcaster, and a writer. She's involved with Empire Comedy Live up there in Toronto.
Mm-hmm. Toronto.
Chrissy is judging by her posts, she's a fan of Batman 66, Star Trek, the original series, and a big fan of 007, which is very cool.
Wow. Yeah.
Chrissy, we are very gratified that you are a listener, and thanks so much.
Thanks, Chrissy.
Thanks,
Chrissy.
Thank you, Chrissy.
Chrissy.
And let's remind our listeners that you can find us on Facebook and on YouTube at Monster Party TV. Our Twitter handle is at Monster Party HQ. Also on Instagram, Monster Party HQ. We are now also available on Google Play Music for those of you who have an Android. And if you're listening to us on iTunes, please take a moment and write a review. We would love to hear from you.
iTunes.
Thanks, Ron. That sounds so good. Reminder. Oh, nice.
Sounds good.
Oh, just keep going. We also have our Monster Party cap available for sale.
Great quality cap.
Cap.
An incredible quality, this cap. You have no idea. It's
quality.
No, I'm serious. It is a quality hat.
It's very.
It has like over 17,000 stitches in the
stitched,
little title.
Stitched by monkeys.
No, it's not stitched by
it
monkeys.
It's a great hat.
And
it
our eBay store. It's available on our eBay store, which is Monster Party Store. Easy to remember.
Cool.
eBay.
Got a voice you could just curl up and go to sleep in.
Sleep.
this has been great. And you've been listening to Monster Party, a presentation of the Fangoria Podcast Network. It's produced by Matt Weinhold and executive produced by Thomas DeFeo and Ken Hanley of Fangoria Entertainment. For press opportunities, advertising inquiries, and information about Monster Party, contact Ken at Fangoria.com.
On that note, I am Matt Weinhold.
I am Sean Sheridan.
I'm Larry Strothe.
And I'm James Gonis.
I am Ron Lynch.
Keep America strong!
Watch Ripoffs and Wannabes.
Ripoffs and Wannabes. I need another drink.
Yeah.
Wait, let's stop here for a moment.
Yeah.
No.
I'm just grab one.
We're gonna get a beer. We've got to keep the booze coming.
I can't be the only person. Keep going.
You won't be the only person.
No,
yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm gonna get you one.
I'm gonna go to the bathroom.
Oh, we are stopping.
You got a second?
Beer or?
Got a little fire?
Yeah, I got time. I got plenty of time.
I want to mention a couple more aliens. Are you having fun?
Is this fun?
This is the best podcast I've ever done.
Yeah.
Except for you, Larry. Okay. My girlfriend is so into the shark movies. Like, I've walked in and she's watching Atomic Shark, and I went, how could you watch this? It's really a waste of your time. Watch 5 minutes of it. Watch 10 minutes of it.
That's actually really good advice.
But yeah. But then she said, but I also have Shark Planet. And I went, well, what's that? She goes, well, it's a planet full of water, and it's populated by sharks. And I said, there have to be people on the planet, right? And she goes, yeah. So we start watching it, and I can't stop watching it. It's like it's all water, and there's like bases on the thing, and one base gets eliminated immediately because the sharks fly into the air and just knock people into the water and then eat them.
Wow.
And one girl gets put into a barrel, and she survives this whole city. And there's like a science city, like a lab where all the scientists are, and they're planning a rocket that will go into space and there's too much. It's like the melting of the ice caps here. It's all water because of that. But they're going to send something into space and add CO2 or take away CO2. What would it be? Take away CO2 so that the water recedes.
Okay.
And there's land masses.
So all the people on the bases are indigenous. Like they were original. Was it like a water world type thing where no, they don't?
It looks
that.
Like water world when it starts.
Okay.
That's what it looks like.
Okay.
But the bases, I don't know how they built them. I don't know where they got. One place is just a warehouse, and for some reason it's on the water, built on the water. But it's like metal. There's all kinds of metal. And I'm thinking, I have a geology degree. Where'd the metal come from? You need rocks.
Well,
there's no rocks.
Underwater?
Maybe. I mean, everything's underwater.
We're already writing this better.
All right.
Right, exactly.